Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Douglas MacArthur, American Warrior, by Arthur Herman. Narrated by Henry Strozier. Preface. You can see him in your mind's eye. The khaki uniform and pressed pants, the gold-braided cap, the sunglasses, the corncob pipe firmly in his teeth, and the ramrod straight back. In the mind's eye, we see him wading ashore in the Philippines, sitting in a jeep in Korea, or accepting the surrender of the Empire of Japan on board the USS Missouri. As the years passed, Americans grew to see him as a pillar of strength, or a tower of vanity, a man ready to be the savior of his country, or a man the country needed to be saved from. He was Douglas MacArthur, arguably the last American public figure to be worshipped unreservedly as a national hero, and arguably the last to bring the romantic stirrings of a Custer or a Robert E. Lee to the American military tradition. Yet he also foresaw the greatest geopolitical shift for his nation's future since its founding, away from Europe and toward Asia and the Pacific Rim. It's not difficult to find polarizing figures in American history, but none is more intriguing or more significant than Douglas MacArthur. Was he prophet or anachronism? Romantic hero or vain mountebank? It's what biographers and historians have debated back and forth in the half century since his death. There are more than 25 separate biographies of Douglas MacArthur, and many more books on his military campaigns, from World War I in the Philippines to Korea. Most, however, fall into two categories. There are the unrelenting critics like Richard Rovere and Arthur Schlesinger, Jr., The General and the President, New York, 1951, Gavin Long, MacArthur as Military Commander, London, 1969, Carol Petillo, Douglas MacArthur, The Philippine Years, Bloomington, Indiana, 1981, Michael Schaller, Douglas MacArthur, The Far Eastern General, Oxford, 1989, and most recently, Russell Buchheit, Douglas MacArthur, Statecraft and Stagecraft in America's East Asian Policy, Lanham, Maryland, 2008. Then there's the category of unashamed adulation, as in Fraser Hunt, The Untold Story of Douglas MacArthur, New York, 1964. Charles Willoughby and John Chamberlain, MacArthur, 1941 through 1951, New York, 1954. Courtney Whitney, MacArthur, His Rendezvous with History, New York, 1955, and MacArthur's Own Reminiscences, New York, 1964. As for the rest, the most scholarly biography, D. Clayton James's The Years of MacArthur, 3 volumes, New York, 1970 through 1985, is balanced but exhausting to read, and has become increasingly out of date. The only single-volume biographies for general readers, William Manchester's American Caesar, Douglas MacArthur, 1880 through 1964, Boston, 1978, and Jeffrey Perrett, Old Soldiers Never Die, The Life of Douglas MacArthur, New York, 1996, both suffer from unevenly critical perspectives on their subject, and never fulfill the promise of their themes or their authors. In short, it is time for a biography of MacArthur that gives this larger-than-life figure his full due by peeling back the layers of myth, both pro and con, and revealing the marrow of the man and his career. By using available archive sources, including the huge collection of materials from the MacArthur Library in Norfolk, Virginia, as well as newly declassified materials from the National Archives and the U.S. Center of Military History, and the scholarship of leading Japanese as well as Australian and Korean scholars, it is now possible to set one of the legends of American history, in many ways an American Churchill, firmly in his time and place and profession. This volume will show how much of the man remained hidden from the public image, and how and why the emergence of Douglas MacArthur as an American hero was actually a process of conscious self-creation. This is also the first biography to make use of the new Soviet and Chinese archive sources, which shed considerable new light on the events leading up to the outbreak of the war in Korea, particularly the real facts behind China's intervention in the conflict. In addition, it is the first to make full use of the complete 1998 oral interview with Jean MacArthur, the interview she swore she would never give, which is now safely ensconced in the archives of the MacArthur Memorial. What readers will discover in these pages is that far from being a remote figure from the historical past, MacArthur was an individual whose life and career is very much one for our time. For example, more than any other American in the 20th century, MacArthur understood the importance of Asia for his country's future destiny. As readers will learn, he was a far-sighted prophet who predicted the rise of the Pacific Rim after World War II, and who remains a figure as significant in the history of Asia as in American history, possibly even more so. "It was crystal clear to me," MacArthur once wrote, "that the future, and indeed the very existence of America, were irrevocably intertwined with Asia." He lived that conviction all his life. It motivated many of his key decisions, including in World War II in Korea. And his impatience with American politicians who still saw Europe as the necessary focus of strategy and foreign policy was legendary. By any measure, the man who warned John F. Kennedy not to get involved in Vietnam and who said, "Anyone who starts a land war in Asia ought to have his head examined," deserves a fresh new look. Indeed, from Vietnam and Nixon's 1972 opening to China, to the current crisis in Europe, not to mention the emergence of post-war Japan and the little dragons, including Taiwan, Singapore, and South Korea, and the rise of mainland China as the next great superpower, MacArthur's life and career may be more relevant than ever for understanding our world today. Certainly no one can deny the epic breadth of that life and career. When MacArthur was born in the Little Rock Army Barracks, American soldiers were still reeling from the massacre at Little Bighorn 4 years before. When he died, American soldiers were deploying in Vietnam, the war he specifically warned President Kennedy to steer clear of. When he entered West Point, generals who had commanded his father in the Civil War were still alive, and Orville and Wilbur Wright's first flight was 4 years away. When he spoke at West Point for the last time in 1962, Americans were headed into space, and jet bombers carrying nuclear weapons circled the North Pole. Over that span of 84 years, Douglas MacArthur spent his entire career in uniform. Indeed, he knew no other life. He was born and died in military hospitals. His first memory, as he recounted in his autobiography, was the sound of bugles at his father's tiny military post where he was born in 1880. MacArthur's death in 1964 was treated as a national event, with his funeral broadcast on network TV with the scale and solemnity befitting the passing of a great national hero, a hero comparable to another titanic figure who died the following year, namely Winston Churchill. Yet even during his lifetime, armies of critics, some of whom had served with him in the field, dismissed him as a second-rate soldier and a vain, pompous, arrogant publicity hound. Then and later, they could point to his failed defense of the Philippines at the outset of America's entry into the Second World War, which led to the biggest mass surrender in U.S. military history. They pointed to the suppression of the bonus marchers during the Depression by troops under his command, his costly campaign in lives and treasure to retake the Philippines, and his disastrous march toward the Yalu after Incheon during the Korean War, which precipitated what MacArthur had assured everyone would never happen, China's entry into the conflict. Then, as Korea grew into the biggest and most dangerous conflict of the Cold War, MacArthur stunned many by threatening to use nuclear weapons to win it, until a frustrated President Truman dismissed him from command. No wonder biographer William Manchester and others have compared MacArthur to a Greek tragic hero, brought down from the heights of power by his own pride and hubris, or even, some have argued, his incompetence. His supporters and apologists, on the other hand, could point to his great success with the amphibious landings at Incheon in September 1950. Which turned the tide of war and saved the U.S. Army and its NATO allies from being driven into the sea, and saved South Korea forever from the tyranny of its northern neighbor. They could point to his campaign to take New Guinea from the Japanese, with its brilliant use of land, sea, and air power. They were able to celebrate his bravery during World War I, which should have won him the Medal of Honor, and which did make him the youngest brigadier general in American Army history. His reorganization and modernization of West Point while superintendent in the 20s, and his tireless work in the 30s as Army Chief of Staff trying to prevent the Army's total collapse under the weight of shrinking budgets, congressional neglect, and the Great Depression. Above all, they proudly pointed to his role after Japan's surrender in World War II, when he used a combination of firmness and diplomatic skill to bring modern democracy and the traditions of an open society to that defeated country. Those years in Japan earned him the respect and admiration of an entire nation, which still reveres Douglas MacArthur as the equivalent of a modern founding father, the man whose actions and policies, as one Japanese historian has put it, set the course of Japanese history in the second half of the 20th century. So, which version is true? My hope is that by the end of this book, readers will know the answer. Prologue. Tokyo, August 23rd, 1950. Three men in uniform arrived at the airport looking tense and somber. They were America's Joint Chiefs of Staff, the men in charge of the nation's armed services, and they were there on a mission from the President. They were going to tell the Supreme Commander in the Far East, General Douglas MacArthur, to halt his plans to win the war in Korea. At dawn on June 25th, 90,000 North Korean soldiers, backed by 150 Soviet-built tanks, had poured across the border into a defenseless South Korea. Not even 5 years after the end of World War II, the Cold War with the Soviet Union had suddenly turned hot. The only troops available to repel the North Korean attack had been four undermanned, under-equipped divisions in Japan under General Walton Walker. They faced a foe more than twice their number. Day by day, elements of the 24th and 25th Infantry Divisions and the 1st Cavalry went into battle almost from the moment they arrived at Seoul Airport. Tanks were in such short supply that M4 Shermans on display at Fort Knox were taken down from their concrete pedestals, had their engines reinstalled, and then were shipped overseas to join the fight. By the end of July, 94,000 American and South Korean troops were clinging to a narrow perimeter around Pusan at the southern tip of Korea. The fighting was intense, sometimes hand-to-hand. General Walker told his men there was no retreat because there was nowhere to go. We must fight to the end. If they had to die, he said, at least we die fighting together. From the moment General MacArthur had been named Supreme Commander in the Korean Theater, he had been spending days and weeks trying to find a way not only to save his men at Pusan, but also to reverse the tide of war and drive the communists back. A bold amphibious landing far behind enemy lines, MacArthur believed, would allow him to liberate Seoul, relieve the pressure on Walker, and cut off the North Koreans' line of retreat before they recovered. The place he had chosen was Incheon, a port city 150 miles northwest of Pusan and 30 miles east of Seoul, the Korean capital now in communist hands. Instead of the American and South Korean armies being cut off and isolated, it would be the communists. A landing at Incheon, MacArthur predicted, would turn imminent defeat into decisive victory. The moment the Joint Chiefs in Washington got wind of MacArthur's plan, they were aghast. The Army's General Lawton Collins, who had commanded troops and landings in New Georgia during the Second World War, the Navy's Admiral Forrest Sherman, and the Marines' Lemuel Shepard, all remembered the uncertainties and perils of large amphibious operations during the last war, and the high casualties. Collins' predecessor, General Omar Bradley, had told Congress that the Army would never be part of a large amphibious landing again. President Truman and Secretary of Defense George Marshall were equally dubious. Meanwhile, the more military experts studied the situation, the dicier it looked. "We drew up a list of nearly every natural and geographic handicap an amphibious assault might face," one naval staff officer later remembered, "and Incheon had them all." And if MacArthur's plan failed, everyone in Washington realized, it would mean catastrophe for the American cause in Asia. So Truman had dispatched the Joint Chiefs to convince MacArthur to change his mind. No landing at Incheon. By mid-afternoon of July 23rd, they and their aides were jammed into a tiny conference room off MacArthur's office in the Daiichi Insurance Building in Tokyo, where he had been presiding as de facto ruler of Japan since its surrender 5 years before. At the head of the table was MacArthur, tall, handsome, ramrod straight in spite of his 70 years. He was the veteran of American wars in Mexico and the Philippines, decorated commander in 2 world conflicts, and son of a Civil War hero. In 1950, he was the most instantly recognizable American soldier in the world. Many thought it likely he would be the next president of the United States, but not if he lost Korea. He sat silent and expressionless, his pipe gripped tightly in his teeth, as the Joint Chiefs laid out their objections. They pointed out that Incheon's tides were among the largest and most unpredictable in Asia, and that a landing force might well find itself stranded on a series of mud banks, becoming sitting ducks for communist gunners. They explained that the channel entering Incheon Harbor was narrow and winding, and a ship sunk there by an enemy mine could block the entire channel, making the operation impossible. They also protested that MacArthur's plan meant stripping the Pusan perimeter of the 1st Marine Brigade, leaving General Walker's men unnecessarily exposed to a sudden North Korean attack. Finally, General Collins stated that even supposing the Incheon landing succeeded, and MacArthur did drive on to Seoul, it was his personal belief that MacArthur would be too far away to link up with Walker at Pusan, and that if the communist counterattacked, he could easily find himself trapped with no hope of relief. The best plan, the Joint Chiefs had concluded, was for MacArthur to evacuate Pusan and resign himself and America to the fall of South Korea. The conference room fell silent. MacArthur's chief of staff, General Edward Almond, shifted uneasily in his chair. The tension and the temperature in the tiny space steadily rose. Then MacArthur pulled his pipe from his mouth and spoke. He said he understood the objections and the obstacles to an amphibious landing, and that although they were substantial, they were not insuperable. He said, "My confidence in the Navy is complete." And in fact, he added with a sly smile as he glanced over at Admiral Sherman, "I seem to have more confidence in the Navy than the Navy itself." MacArthur went on to explain that taking Incheon and Seoul would cut the enemy's supply line and seal off the entire peninsula. "This, in turn, will paralyze the fighting power of the troops that now face Walker," MacArthur predicted. "Without munitions and food, they will soon be helpless, and can easily be overpowered by our smaller forces." Then, with a sweep of his arm, MacArthur got to his final point. "The prestige of the Western world hangs in the balance," he said. "It is plainly apparent that here in Asia is where the communist conspirators have elected to make their play for global conquest. Make the wrong decision here, the fatal decision of inertia, and we will be done." His eyes grew wide and more determined. "I can almost hear the ticking of the second hand of destiny. We must act now or die." MacArthur rose to his feet and glanced around the stunned and silent room. "Incheon will not fail," he concluded. "Incheon will succeed. And it will save 100,000 lives." Then his voice dropped to almost a whisper. "We shall land at Incheon, and I shall crush them." Three abashed joint chiefs went back to the Tokyo airport and returned to Washington. 6 days later, their telegram arrived on MacArthur's desk, giving the go-ahead for his amphibious landing. America's most distinguished military leader had just made his boldest move ever, and with the landings at Incheon in September 1950, he would witness his greatest triumph in half a century in the U.S. Army. And yet, in less than 3 months, it would only appear as prelude to his most spectacular failure and set the stage for the greatest clash between America's military and civilian leadership since the Civil War. Chapter 1. Son of the Father. An old Scottish proverb says, "Nothing has stood longer than MacArthur, the hills, and the devil." Anyone who wants to understand the life and career of Douglas MacArthur needs to start by understanding the father. There's a photograph of Arthur MacArthur standing by a chair in his Civil War uniform. It's a shock to realize we're looking at a lieutenant in the U.S. Army. He looks more like a boy in costume dress-up, until you look at the face. Under the whiskerless cheeks, still running to baby fat, you can detect the hardness of granite in the mouth as well as in the eyes. A granite he would pass on to his son. Arthur MacArthur was born in Springfield, Massachusetts on June 2, 1845. His father, also named Arthur, was a popular lawyer as well as judge advocate for the militia in the state's Western Military District. Judge Arthur MacArthur Sr. had migrated to Massachusetts from Scotland in 1828. In America, his considerable intelligence and even more considerable charm had won him a series of increasingly lucrative jobs. In little time, he rose from teacher in a one-room school to law clerk in New York City. There, he eventually opened his own law firm. In those days, no one needed a formal law degree to pass the New York bar, and found a wealthy wife, Aurelia Belcher, daughter of a Massachusetts iron manufacturer. Judge MacArthur, an accomplished storyteller and a delightful after-dinner speaker, was a hard man to dislike. People were irresistibly drawn to the man with dark hooded eyes, tousled black hair, and quaint Scottish burr. But all the charm and smoothness that made the judge's career a success stuck with him. What was left for his son, Arthur, was the same perceptive intelligence yoked to a ferocity even a rigidity of will and an emotional opaqueness that would characterize Arthur MacArthur's entire career. That ferocity certainly got him through America's bloodiest war. He showed an unflinching heroism from his first battle at Perryville, the Stones River in December 1862, and then to Missionary Ridge in November 1863, where he single-handedly led the 24th Wisconsin up the steep slopes under heavy fire, carrying the regimental flag and shouting, "On Wisconsin," which would later become the state's motto. From there, MacArthur and the 24th would march south and fight on along the long, bloody road to Atlanta, the hub of Confederate resistance in the West. He was still only 18 when the regiment's commanding officer was wounded and he took over command of the regiment. It was on the eve of fierce fighting at Resaca on the East Tennessee and Georgia Railroad line that passed through Atlanta, the first major hurdle in the North's bid to capture the transportation hub of the Confederacy, Atlanta itself. Everyone realized this was no ordinary 18-year-old. MacArthur, a fellow officer in the 24th Wisconsin named Ed Parsons, and a divisional staff officer were out examining the earthworks that the Wisconsin men had built to MacArthur's specifications. They looked sturdy enough, but the staff officer wondered if the 24th had enough personnel to man them if the Confederates launched a full-scale attack. "Major," he asked MacArthur, "suppose the Rebs should make a charge and attempt to capture this position. What would you do?" MacArthur told him fiercely, "Fight like hell." At the battle for Kennesaw Mountain, Major MacArthur took a bullet in the wrist and another in the chest, but miraculously continued to lead his troops in the fight, on to Peachtree Creek, and finally he and his men and the rest of the Army of the Cumberland marched into a smashed and deserted Atlanta. In 112 days, the Army of the Cumberland had advanced 200 miles and fought 13 major battles. It had cost the 24th Wisconsin 8 officers and 92 enlisted men killed and wounded, with the teenaged Arthur MacArthur in command almost all the way. 3 months later, while the rest of Sherman's army was marching south into Georgia, the 24th saw even tougher fighting at the Battle of Franklin near Nashville on November 30th. There, the 19-year-old's luck finally ran out. 2 bullets, one in the knee and the other in the shoulder, finally laid him low in the battle that every survivor of the 24th agreed was the worst they had ever fought. Worse even than Missionary Ridge. When the last Confederate attack petered out at around 9 p.m., MacArthur's men loaded their critically wounded commander into an ambulance wagon, while fires from the burning houses of Franklin lit up the night sky. His friend Ed Parsons was left in charge of the regiment, while doctors struggled to save MacArthur's leg. They did, and found to their relief that the bullet in the shoulder had passed clean through. So it was a relatively light price to pay for the slaughter at Franklin. When Parsons went to visit MacArthur in the hospital that evening, he remembered finding 4 blood-soaked generals lying side by side on the porch, all dead. It wasn't until mid-February 1865 that Arthur finally returned to his regiment after recuperating at home in Milwaukee, where his mother had died shortly before he arrived. By now, most veterans of the Civil War were sick of the war, including his former commanding officer and the man who had coined the phrase, "War is hell," General William Tecumseh Sherman himself. "I confess without shame that I am tired of war," Sherman wrote to a friend. "Its glory is all moonshine. Only those who have not heard a shot, nor heard the shrills and groans of the wounded and lacerated, friend or foe, cry aloud for more blood and more vengeance and more desolation." Another survivor of the same campaign, Lieutenant Oliver Wendell Holmes, had found the ordeal so shattering that he was never the same man again, even as Supreme Court Justice. Arthur MacArthur had the opposite experience. Far from being repelled by the violence, noise, and danger of war, he loved it, and he learned to close his mind and heart to the suffering it imposed. The supreme thrill of personally leading men through mortal peril to victory and glory would never leave him. In later years, he came to wrap the experience of war and carnage around himself like an old friend, and he would pass that same thrill on to his son. In April 1865, a beaten and battered Confederacy surrendered, and the 24th Wisconsin was able to return home on June the 5th. Arthur MacArthur, now a lieutenant colonel by order of the Wisconsin State Legislature, led his men in a triumphal dress parade down the streets of Milwaukee, while his father, along with the mayor and other dignitaries, proudly watched from their grandstand seats. 5 days later, the 24th Wisconsin was officially disbanded, and Arthur was promoted to full colonel. He was still not yet old enough to vote, but little more than a week after his 20th birthday, he was a war hero and a Wisconsin state legend. There was even talk of recommending him for the Medal of Honor for his bravery on Missionary Ridge. But the curtain of peacetime reality had now come down. Arthur MacArthur's dream was to remain in the Army, but as the Army had shrunk from 1 million men to fewer than 55,000, and from 15,000 officers to only 3,400, with thousands of other veterans clamoring for the handful of remaining vacancies, commands were few and very far between, even for a war hero. So Judge MacArthur, the most popular man in Milwaukee and a growing power in Wisconsin state politics, got into the act. He wrote to his friend Alexander Randall, former Wisconsin governor, now postmaster general, to see if Randall could help get a promotion for young Arthur. The best the Army could come up with for the former lieutenant colonel of the 24th Wisconsin was second lieutenant in the 17th Infantry, which was being reorganized in New York City. Randall obligingly spoke to President Andrew Johnson, as did a Wisconsin senator and the congressman from Milwaukee's district. On October 13th, just as MacArthur's regiment had completed training and was setting out for Texas, Arthur MacArthur found himself promoted to captain. It was not the first time a MacArthur furthered his military career with the help of political patronage, and it would definitely not be the last. Both father and son firmly believed that in the making of a successful military career, there is no substitute for courage and competence and experience. In their long careers, both would display plenty of all three. Plus the other attribute Napoleon said was indispensable for a great general, namely, luck. MacArthur, father and son, also believed they had a kind of genius, a destiny, that would inevitably bring them the rewards they deserved. But why wait and do nothing when a brief but well-placed letter, a friendly meeting over lunch or after dinner, or a kind word from one powerful friend to another, could help to speed up the inevitable? This fortunate promotion, Arthur MacArthur wrote to Postmaster Randall, may decide my life. The undeveloped events of the future may place it in my power to reciprocate. Already he could see himself being in a position to one day return the favor. Arthur's unexpected promotion did ruffle some feathers in the 17th Infantry. It turned out there were no vacancies for captains, certainly none for MacArthur, so Captain MacArthur was reassigned to the 36th Infantry instead, which was stationed in the Nebraska Territory, helping to protect Union Pacific Railroad crews building the Transcontinental Railroad from Indian attacks. It was not until November, however, that he reached the headquarters of the 36th Infantry and his first post-Civil War army post, Fort Kearney. He would have to wait 23 long years before he would see his next promotion. What followed for Arthur MacArthur were 2 decades in what would come to be called the Old Army, as he traveled from one far-flung army post to another in a series of scenes that could have been from a John Ford movie. The wooden stockade guarding a small collection of whitewashed buildings clustered around a flagpole and a dusty parade ground. The tedious patrols and monotonous fatigue duties played out in front of endless stretches of prairie and sagebrush desert with sandstone cliffs or dark snow-capped mountains framing the horizon. Occasional shots traded with disgruntled bands of Indians, while a steady procession of Cheyenne, Sioux, Comanche, and Kiowa, as well as buffalo, antelope, elk, and characters from future westerns, the unshaven, buckskin-clad frontiersman, the trapper, trader, trooper, and pioneer homeseeker, paraded past each post and each patrol, from Nebraska and Arkansas to Texas, New Mexico, Utah, and Wyoming. Above all, there was boredom. Everywhere there was the same routine, from 5:45 first bugle call in reveille, followed by raising of the flag at 6:10, through breakfast and assembly, to setting out for work on building bridges and stringing telegraph wires, to roll call in the evening and lights out at 11 p.m. For Arthur, this routine was broken only occasionally by some memorable event. He would be present, for example, on May 10, 1869, when Leland Stanford drove in the Golden Spike joining the Union Pacific and Central Pacific Railroads at Promontory Summit, Utah, as America's transcontinental railroad was finally complete. In January 1871, he was given leave to attend the wedding of his father and his new wife, who was 7 years the judge's junior, in Washington, D.C., where his father now made his home. This wife, Judge MacArthur's third, was the daughter of a highly successful congressman. But otherwise, those first 8 years of Army service were ones of brain-crushing tedium, for an Army officer with no vices except perhaps the occasional glass of whiskey during a game of whist for minor stakes. To relieve the boredom, Arthur MacArthur mostly read. He would have the judge send books on to him at his various posts, in addition to stacks of journals like Harper's Weekly, North American Review, and Blackwood's Magazine. We know MacArthur had a fascination for economics, and authors like Adam Smith, David Ricardo, John Stuart Mill, and Walter Bagehot, as well as works on ancient and modern history. There was also a growing shelf on China and Japan, not to mention everything and anything he could get his hands on regarding military strategy. But as he sat and read and pondered, or sat in the pew at his father's wedding among the delighted guests and the orange blossoms, he must have wondered when, if ever, he would be married. He was nearing 30 when his new regiment, the 18th Infantry, was transferred to Jackson Barracks outside New Orleans. There he would meet the woman who would transform his life and serve as a pillar of strength both for Arthur and for his even more famous son. Mary Pinckney Hardy was a true Southern belle. If Arthur MacArthur was John Wayne from a John Ford Western, Pinky Hardy was Scarlett O'Hara from Gone with the Wind. Headstrong, vivacious, and darkly beautiful, she was the daughter of a wealthy merchant from Norfolk. Her son Douglas, for whom she would become the single most important person in his life, described her heritage this way. Mary Pinckney Hardy came from an old Virginia family dating back to Jamestown days. Her ancestors had fought under George Washington and Andrew Jackson, and her brothers, products of the Virginia Military Institute, had followed Robert E. Lee's flag on Virginia's bloody fields. A Hardy was at Stonewall Jackson's elbow that dark night when he fell on the sodden plank road near Chancellorsville. Despite the associations with the South's lost cause, her father, Thomas, was no slave-owning plantation owner, and River Edge, the family home outside Norfolk, was no Tara. As a businessman specializing in fertilizer rather than cotton, he had emerged from the Civil War with his fortune more or less intact. Mary, born in 1852, was the 11th of 14 children, and had grown up in North Carolina and then Baltimore while the family home was occupied by a Union General Benjamin Butler and then rebuilt after being used as an army hospital. Summers during and after the war were spent at a house in Massachusetts. Three of her older sisters had already married Northerners when she, on a visit to New Orleans, caught the eye of a handsome but imperious-looking young Union officer at a ball. Although the 18th was in town as part of the Reconstruction occupation of the South by federal troops, animosity toward the victors by the vanquished was less fierce in New Orleans than any other southern city. Captain Arthur MacArthur had found himself accepted as part of the normal social scene. When the vibrant young Miss Hardy crossed his path, he impetuously proposed. She impetuously accepted, and the Catholic wedding ceremony took place at St. Mary's Church in Norfolk on May 19, 1875. Marrying Northerners was one thing in the Hardy family, but marrying a Yankee war hero was another. Two of Mary's brothers refused to attend. Mary's mother, already badly shaken by the war, fell deeper into a depression that hastened her death in 1881. But Mary refused to be daunted. She had chosen a man who represented the new American future, not the Southern past. She had chosen a man of no fortune except his talents and his brains, one whose career would inevitably take her to the remotest places in America. Yet her course was set, as was Arthur's. They would be devoted to each other for the next 37 years in a marriage, as their son Douglas noted, of perfect union, though he would live to know just the opposite. For a year and a half, the married couple lived in suspended bliss. With the help of Judge MacArthur, the Army Adjutant General arranged for Captain MacArthur to enjoy 16 months of detached duty in Washington, D.C., where Pinky was able to attend parties, delight in the judge's charming conversation at table with his influential friends, and on June 1, 1876, give birth to their first son, Arthur III. Even her husband's recall to duty in New Orleans in December didn't entirely disrupt the honeymoon, although life in Jackson Barracks was a rude introduction to the rigorous routine of Army life. Pinky MacArthur took every opportunity to return to New England during the 3 years while her husband served as commander of K Company, 18th Infantry, until October 1878, when a second son, Malcolm, was born in New Britain, Connecticut, while she was traveling with her mother. The hammer fell in the spring of 1879, when, after rejoining her husband in New Orleans, an outbreak of yellow fever sent the 18th Infantry fleeing north, first to Chattanooga, which must have been a grim reunion for the 30-year-old Arthur, and then to Atlanta, ditto, until finally taking up quarters in Little Rock, Arkansas. Pinky was again pregnant. The plan was to have her bear her third child at River Edge, but the baby came prematurely on January 26, 1880, while they were still settling in at the Little Rock barracks. They named him Douglas. He was scrawny, small, and weak, like most premature babies. Some in her family wondered if he would be strong enough to survive. But Judge MacArthur was delighted. The boy had been born on his 63rd birthday. Douglas would grow up to be his grandfather's favorite, although his mother and father were devoted to his brothers, Arthur and Malcolm. The way the Norfolk papers covered the birth, as MacArthur later recalled, was, Douglas MacArthur was born on January 26th while his parents were away. He was in some ways a provisional baby, the male backup in case his two elder brothers didn't survive. Of the 14 Hardy children, only 10 had made it to adulthood. In fact, it was Douglas who would outlast and outshine them both, and become an army legend even exceeding his father's fame. A source of pride, but also ambivalence, for the rest of his life. That July, Captain MacArthur was ordered to join Company K at Fort Wingate in New Mexico to help guard workers building the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe Railway. Six-month-old Douglas was deemed strong enough to make the journey, so with the baby, 4-year-old Arthur III, and 19-month-old Malcolm in tow, Pinky and her husband set out in the full heat of summer on a trek across Arkansas, Louisiana, and Texas, until they reached their destination 100 miles northwest from Albuquerque, and a lifetime away from anywhere else. The post was even worse than Pinky could have imagined. Set high in the Zuni Mountains along the Continental Divide, Wingate baked in summer and froze in winter. Rattlesnakes and Gila monsters haunted the nearby mesas and dry river basins. Their quarters were a small, one-story adobe building with a flat dirt roof, with the inside ceiling lined with canvas to keep out the scorpions. The family of five shared two rooms and a kitchen, with a rough wooden floor. Quarters for the enlisted ranks did not even have that. No wonder that in 1881 through 82, 248 of the 444 enlisted men in the 13th Infantry chose to desert. The same thought must have crossed Pinky's mind, but she had her delicate hands full nursing two babies and caring for toddler Arthur, while her husband focused on camp duties. There were few women at Fort Wingate, and even fewer opportunities for socializing. And so it was in the evening at dinner that Pinky must have poured out her frustrations to her husband and urged him over and over to resign his commission and go into business like her father. Arthur refused. He loved the army and performed his duties with a competence and rectitude that impressed every officer who had contact with him. He was still convinced that he was destined for higher things. All he needed was the right opportunity, a lucky break, to show what he was meant to do, and take him and the family far away from the mesas, mountains, and the scorpions. That break came in the autumn of 1881, following the death of Mary's mother. Arthur applied for leave to take the family east, and they arrived in Norfolk in early May 1882. Days were spent dividing up the Hardy estate. Arthur and Pinky came away with $40,000, a minor fortune in those days. And then Arthur set off for Washington to visit his father and his new wife at their house on N Street. His father's range of political contacts had grown to the highest levels of the government, and included important figures in both political parties. There was even talk that the judge might be in the running for a seat on the U.S. Supreme Court. One of those contacts was Ulysses S. Grant, Arthur's former commander-in-chief at Missionary Ridge and now a former president. He was delighted to learn that, in addition to military history, Captain MacArthur had an interest in Asia and China. As it happened, Grant had just returned from Asia, and he had been deeply impressed by what he had seen. The trip had been part of a world tour that Grant and his wife and sons had conducted in 1877, starting in England, where they had met Queen Victoria, and moving on to France, Germany, Russia, and Egypt. Back in the United States, the former president found himself stalked by scandal and accusations of incompetence during his administration. But abroad, he was treated as a hero and a celebrity by adoring crowds and awestruck politicians. And so, after visiting the pyramids, Grant had decided to extend their tour for another year and press on to the Far East. Ever since Commodore Perry had first sailed into Yokohama Harbor in 1854, Americans had been fascinated and drawn to Asia and the Pacific. "There is the East, there is India," proclaimed Thomas Hart Benton to an audience in St. Louis, as he pointed due west past the Rockies to California, which Americans of every political stripe saw as the gateway for American commerce and trade in Asia. The dream was that the networks of commerce flowing from the United States would free the East, what Walt Whitman called venerable priestly Asia, from the shackles of superstition, tyranny, and poverty, while completing America's redemptive role as a beacon of freedom in the world. In 1844, Secretary of State Caleb Cushing negotiated a Most Favored Nation trading treaty with Imperial China. In 1867, the United States purchased Alaska from Russia, in part to serve as a bridge to Asia. A year later, America acquired a tiny atoll in the mid-Pacific that it dubbed Midway Island, since it sat midway between California and Japan. And in 1875, Grant himself had negotiated a reciprocity treaty with the independent Kingdom of Hawaii, or shipping pineapples grown by American farmers in the islands to the United States. But Grant was also interested in something else. He spelled it out on his visit to China after spending several weeks in India, including touring the Taj Mahal. He told a large audience in Canton, "I am not prepared to justify the treatment the Chinese have received at the hands of the foreigner," meaning European powers like Britain and Russia. He foresaw a possible future role for the United States in Asia besides trade, that of protecting the nations of the region from outside aggressors as Asia emerged into the modern world. It was a point he returned to when he and his wife sailed into Nagasaki Harbor on June 21, 1879, on the USS Richmond. Japanese naval vessels fired ceremonial 21-gun salutes, while other ships circled the harbor waving American flags. As crowds waved from the quays and cliffs and set up bonfires to light their way at night. Japan had embarked on its crash program of modernization, the Meiji reforms, 11 years earlier, and Grant was impressed by everything he saw. "The country is beautifully cultivated," he wrote to a friend. "The scenery is grand, the people from the highest to the lowest, the most kindly in the world." He was particularly impressed by Japan's new railways and trains, as modern and up-to-date as anything on the Union Pacific line. And at the immense state dinner in his honor on June 23rd, he spoke to his rapt audience of his vision for the future of both Japan and America. "America has great interests in the East. She is your next-door neighbor. She is more affected by the Eastern populations than any other power," he told the Japanese, a clear reference to the growing Chinese and Japanese immigrant populations in California and on the American West Coast. "We have rejoiced over your progress," he said. "We have watched you step by step. We have followed the unfolding of your old civilization and its absorbing the new. You have our profound sympathy in that work, and sympathy in the troubles which come with it, and our friendship. I hope it may continue. I hope it may long continue." The highlight of the visit was Grant's meeting with Japan's emperor, the Tenno, on August 10th. It was not an entirely ceremonial meeting. While in China, the Chinese Emperor's Viceroy, General Li Hongqiang, had asked the former president if he would help negotiate a peace with Japan over some islands that both countries were claiming. The Ryukyus, the principal island of which was a 20-square-mile rocky promontory called Okinawa. Grant had agreed, and during his meeting he managed to arrange the deal and secure a peace treaty, thus foreshadowing the role that Teddy Roosevelt would play in brokering an end to the Russo-Japanese War in 1905. By the time he arrived back in San Francisco, Ulysses S. Grant had inaugurated a new era in U.S.-Asian relations. He would be eager to talk about it with the intelligent young army captain who seemed as enthusiastic about Asia as Grant was. They spoke together over several days, with Grant describing his impressions of his visits with Chinese and Japanese politicians, and Captain MacArthur intently absorbing every detail. Grant was convinced that something extraordinary was happening in both China and Japan. A new era in Asia's relations with the world was underway, and that the United States needed to be part of it. America has much to gain in the East, Grant was telling listeners. No nation has greater interests, except America has nothing to gain except what ensures them as much benefit as it does us. I'd be ashamed of my country, Grant emphasized, if its relations with other nations, especially with these ancient and most interesting empires in the East, were based on any other ideas. And MacArthur, no doubt, would have enthusiastically agreed. Then Grant had an idea. Why didn't MacArthur apply to the War Department to be sent to China as a military attaché? Grant promised he would use what influence he had with the department and with President Chester Arthur to try to get him the post. MacArthur was thrilled at the offer. He immediately filled out the paperwork for an application while also seeking a 6-month extension of his leave. By then, he hoped, the War Department would have weighed his case. Read Grant's letters of recommendation, the ex-president wrote several, and he and Pinky and the boys would be bound for the exotic East. It did not quite work out that way. First, his request for leave was denied, and he was forced to make the 2,000-mile trip in just 6 days by himself. His wife absolutely refused to go and urged him to quit his commission rather than submit to the humiliation. It was not until October 1882 that he finally was granted leave to return to Norfolk and his family. It was there that he put the final touches on what he considered his ace in the hole for securing the post in China. It was a 44-page manuscript that Arthur MacArthur had written and typed out himself, titled Chinese Memorandum. It was, in fact, a scholarly tour d'horizon of American foreign policy in Asia, which he had put together with his usual ferocious concentration of energy and focus, the same technique that would mark his son Douglas's approach to any new or important task. He then sent it on to Grant, who forwarded it to President Arthur. By any standard, it is an extraordinary document, especially considering it was written by someone who had never visited Asia. It did, however, reflect an intense reading of Oriental as well as European history, including the history of Russia. And although it antedates Alfred Thayer Mahon's influence of sea power upon history, and future pronouncements by Senator Henry Cabot Lodge, Albert Beveridge, and Theodore Roosevelt by almost a decade, their basic theme that the future of America lies westward in the Pacific is all there. Indeed, 10 years before Professor Frederick Jackson Turner published a famous essay prophesying the end of the U.S. frontier, MacArthur, who was actually serving on that frontier, did the same. America's overland expansion and settlement westward was all but over, MacArthur predicted, The nation would need a new challenge to mobilize its energies and peoples. That challenge, MacArthur announced, was Asia. Two nations in particular, he noted, are making their way back into the old continent, where the Aryan race began. One was Great Britain, the other, Russia. MacArthur then described how in the past 40 years, Russia had annexed one swath of Central Asia after another, until it now stood on the doorstep of Imperial China. From the other end of the continent, Britain had advanced across the Indian subcontinent northward to Afghanistan and Nepal. Conventional wisdom had it that either Great Britain or Russia would dominate the future of Asia, and particularly China, which, despite long years of decadence and decline, was still the richest empire existing on the face of the earth. Arthur MacArthur, however, had a third candidate, America. Indeed, the United States cannot exist as a commanding and progressive nationality unless we secure and maintain the sovereignty of the Pacific. It was a bold and daring proposition, one that, from the perspective of America's relative place in the world and the technologies of 1882, must have seemed beyond ordinary comprehension. But MacArthur saw this American dominance arising not through conquest, but through trade. He proposed creation of a vast trans-Pacific commercial network that would open China to American influence and extend that influence beyond the borders of China, including to Japan and the rest of Eastern Asia. Indeed, MacArthur saw the competition for dominance in not material but ideological terms. There are two, and only two, kinds of polities in the world today, he announced, the Empire and the Republic. One was embodied by Russia, ruthless and autocratic, the embodiment of the drive for military power and acquisition of wealth and territory at any cost. The other was reflected by the United States, the modern embodiment of the virtues of self-government and the rule of law, whose expansionist urges sprang from the bottom up rather than imperial diktat. America as the fulfillment of mankind's democratic impulses rather than its imperial ones, and the embodiment of a future built around commerce more than military might. It seems inevitable that the Empire and the Republic are destined to meet in Asia, MacArthur wrote. The fate of the world, indeed of freedom, hung in the balance of which principle prevailed. It was as if he could see in a crystal ball his son and his army's agonies on the Korean Peninsula almost 70 years later. America certainly had a material stake in expanding its markets into Asia. The American Republic can never acquire its full complement of riches and power if it permits itself to be excluded from the field of Asiatic commerce, he wrote. But in Arthur MacArthur's mind, the issue went beyond commerce and money-making. American trade would serve as an opening for the propagation of American ideas, including the concepts of republican liberty and human freedom. In the later pages of his Chinese memorandum, MacArthur even foresaw a day when California and America's West Coast would serve as a vast emporium of trade and influence spreading across the Pacific. In the process, American trade would serve as a social and economic crucible in which the nations of Asia, including China, that seemed doomed to a state of decline and decadence, might suddenly revive. Once let these torpid communities be set in motion, he predicted, once mix them again by travel and commerce, and the aspect of things might quickly change. Asia, he wrote in a sentence that seems to leap gleaming off the page, may yet be destined to exhibit the greatest of political wonders. Yet if the Russian imperial idea prevailed, the opposite would happen. The hegemony of Russia would have disastrous consequences both for America's future in geopolitical and ideological terms, and also for the future enlightenment of China and the rest of Asia. In short, self-interest, sound economy, and pure morals agree in their judgments, Captain MacArthur opined, and corroborate each other, and point us to the Orient as the field of our future labors. There we must contend for commercial power and perhaps combat for political supremacy. That momentous fight, he believed, would begin with China, where the possibility of a rapid development of an effectual military spirit in the Chinese Empire is perhaps as interesting and important as any that may hereafter affect the civilization of the world. And he wanted to be part of that interesting and important mission as military attaché. In the end, it did not happen. Despite former President Grant's best efforts, MacArthur never got an appointment. In fact, it would be 6 years before the United States appointed military attachés to any foreign country, and then largely in Europe and Latin America. Yet, as a document, MacArthur's Chinese memorandum is also a personal landmark. From that date, the future of the MacArthur family shifted decisively away from America or Europe and toward Asia. For both Arthur MacArthur and his son Douglas, Asia would be the arena in which their careers would take root and where they would earn their greatest laurels as military commanders. And for both father and son, the principles set forth in the 1882 memorandum would continue to influence their vision of America's role in Asia and what Asia's bright future could be with America's help. For the present, however, the disappointment of not getting the post was overshadowed by a shattering event that would change the MacArthur family dynamic and Douglas MacArthur forever. Chapter 2: Turning Points. Captain MacArthur signed the finished copy of his Chinese memorandum on January 15, 1883. Less than 3 months later, a devastating bout of measles swept through the MacArthur family as they were staying at the Hardy estate at River Edge. And on April 12th, 4.5-year-old Malcolm died. The grief-stricken captain, Pinky, and their two surviving boys watched as Malcolm's little coffin was laid to rest in the Hardy family plot at Cedar Grove Cemetery. For Arthur MacArthur, the boy's death confirmed him in his steady retreat into the routine of work and duty. He avoided attending social events, stopped playing cards, and maintained a stony silence in the face of his wife's entreaties that he give up the army and start life over again in the civilian world. For 3-year-old Douglas, the loss of the brother who had been his constant playmate must have been equally devastating, as well as frightening. As historian Carol Patillo, who has delved deeply into the MacArthur childhood, concluded, he suddenly found himself abandoned by his best friend, without understanding why. It was Pinky MacArthur for whom the death caused the greatest change. Coming so soon after her mother's death, and in the same house, his loss was a terrible blow to my mother, Douglas later admitted in his memoirs. Her grief became at times overwhelming, as well as life-transforming. Sometimes I nearly go crazy over my loss, she wrote to her sister Elizabeth, who had recently lost her husband. But she could take comfort that little Malcolm and Elizabeth's husband were now before Jesus, pleading for us. It was a sad party that returned to Fort Wingate for that summer, fall, and winter. Only the news that Captain MacArthur had been reassigned to Fort Selden in far southern New Mexico, close to the Rio Grande, his first independent command, broke the routine of grief, silence, and collective misery. The 300-mile trip to Selden involved considerable danger. Geronimo's band of Apaches was preparing one last breakout from their reservation near the MacArthur's route, and hardship. But for three-year-old Douglas, it was filled with excitement as well. In his memoirs, he records it as his first conscious memory. To him, the world of Fort Selden seemed like a Wild West story come to life. "It was here I learned to ride and shoot even before I could read or write," he remembered later. "Indeed, almost before I could walk and talk. While his mother used to dress him in skirts and full blouses and to curl his hair, which hung down to his shoulders, life at Fort Selden now introduced him to the world of masculine skills and duties and the romance of the West. It was a land bright with promise, scarred only by wind and weather, a land with unknown mountains to be climbed, alluring trails to be ridden, streams to be navigated by the strong and vigorous, and all of it guarded by strong men in blue, who marched out every day with their rifles on their shoulders into the blazing sun of summer or the freezing cold of winter, and returned every night while we would stand at attention as the bugle sounded the lowering of the flag. There was even one comic moment when they were out riding and their horses and mules panicked at a strange smell. Then something suddenly loomed on the horizon. A shaggy ghost out of the page of Wonderful. It was an Egyptian camel, the pitiful survivor of the herd that Secretary of War Jeff Davis had bought for the Army in 1855 as pack animals in the American desert. A clever experiment in cross-cultural exchange that never caught on. The memories of Fort Selden would become increasingly precious to Douglas MacArthur. They would contain the last distant echoes of an American frontier way of life that was vanishing even then, as his father had predicted. "Life was vivid and exciting for me," he later wrote of those days, and his missing playmate Malcolm was soon all but forgotten. But one person did not forget Malcolm. That was Pinky, who continued to nurse her grief and now directed all her love and attention on the one person who mattered most to her, her youngest son. After her husband left for work and her oldest son for school, she and Douglas would be alone for the entire day, just as Arthur, the eldest, was increasingly a part of her husband's orbit and his clear favorite, so Douglas now became the center of her life. She also did something extraordinary for her time and place. As she wrote to her sister from Fort Selden, "Arthur is in command, and I can do just as I want." On one of her frequent trips east, she had herself fitted with an early birth control device called a pessary. The message to her husband was clear. There will be no more children. The four of them were now the only family they would have, and the emotional bond that her own mother had had to share with 14 children, Pinky would focus on one in particular, her youngest son, Douglas. Until her death in 1935, she would be the single most important woman, indeed the most important person, in his life. When he was a boy, she would be there to extricate him from dangers and build his self-confidence. When he was a man, she would reassure him at times of challenge and crisis, advise him at critical turning points in his military career, comfort him during times of loss, and share in moments of triumph. Nearly every day for the next 52 years, his mother would be his daily guide, support, and protector, and propel him forward to heights of accomplishment and fame that her husband, serving in the same profession, could only imagine. The death of his brother Malcolm in 1883 was the first major turning point in Douglas MacArthur's life. The second came 6 years later when his father finally won the promotion to major that he had sought for so long and moved the family to Washington, D.C. And Douglas finally got to know his grandfather. The tousled black hair had turned white, and there was now a decided paunch around the judge's middle. But the sparkling wit and beguiling charm that had won the hearts of three wives won him a seat on the Supreme Court of the District of Columbia for 17 years, and turned him from a down-at-the-heels Scottish immigrant into one of the most influential men in the nation's capital, was still there. For the boys, used to their stern, subdued father, their grandfather was like a deep draught of a life-giving elixir. "I could listen to his anecdotes for hours," Douglas later recalled. In their grandfather's study, amid the books and leather-bound chairs, Arthur and Douglas would sit spellbound for hours as the judge wove stories about famous law cases, together with the tales about Scotland and the MacArthur clan, a branch of Clan Campbell that claimed to trace its roots back to King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table. Through their grandfather's words, they could visualize the MacArthur clan marching off to battle in the mists of the Highlands, wearing their tartans of green, black, and gold. And he could hear the clan motto, which the judge would repeat in his thickest Scottish burr. "'Tis green for the sheen o' the pines, and black for the gloom o' the glen. 'Tis gold for the gleam of the gorse. The MacArthur tartan, ye ken." Above all, Judge MacArthur told the boys about the battlefield exploits of their father. He recited for them by the hour the record of Arthur MacArthur's heroism on Missionary Ridge, and at the Battle of Franklin, and on Kennesaw Mountain. Douglas had rarely heard his father say anything about the Civil War, except in a self-deprecating way. It was his grandfather who turned a rather stuffy and unapproachable father into a figure of heroic, even epic, proportions. Certainly the description in MacArthur's own autobiography of his father's charge up Missionary Ridge, gasping breath from tortured lungs, "The charge is losing momentum. They falter, and then suddenly on the crest, the flag," conveys some flavor of what those exciting afternoons in his grandfather's study must have been like. Meanwhile, from his desk at the Adjutant General's office at the War Department, Major MacArthur was busy in securing the Medal of Honor that he believed was rightfully his for his actions on Missionary Ridge almost 30 years earlier. For years, he, like other officers, had been told that the newly created Congressional Medal of Honor was reserved for enlisted men, not officers. But in April 1890, he discovered that Congress had amended the law in 1863 to allow commissioned officers to receive the medal. The War Department had ignored the change, but three commissioned officers had received medals after the war, and one of them, Captain John C. Burke, had won it for conspicuous bravery at the Battle of Murfreesboro, the very same battle in which MacArthur had distinguished himself for the first time. So Major MacArthur submitted an application for his own Medal of Honor, complete with testimonials from the generals who had commanded him at Murfreesboro, Missionary Ridge, Kennesaw Mountain, and the Battle of Franklin, and even from fellow officers who had been eyewitnesses to the fighting. The board was impressed, and on June 30, 1890, awarded him the Medal of Honor for conspicuous bravery at Missionary Ridge. They figured he deserved it equally well for his actions at Murfreesboro and Franklin, but Missionary Ridge was such a prominent example that it became the basis of the citation. Persistence pays. Don't let the bureaucrats keep you down. Keep asking the same question until you get the answer you want. These were the lessons Douglas MacArthur would learn from his father's experience with the Medal of Honor. Indeed, winning the nation's highest military award for himself would become his own obsession as a soldier, one that would cause him considerable turmoil and generate controversy more than once. The next turning point in Douglas's life was the move to San Antonio, Texas, when his father was assigned as assistant adjutant general to the military district there. It was actually a happy time for the MacArthur family. His mother enjoyed the social life of San Antonio and the fort, where her husband was able to hire her a maid. She and other army wives were able to spend leisurely afternoons visiting the town's shops and restaurants, a far cry from life at Fort Selden. The major himself settled into the Fort Houston routine, knowing that he was the master of his chosen work. Every duty assigned to you, you have performed thoroughly and conscientiously, his commanding officer, General Kelton, wrote. I regard your assignment to duty a most fortunate circumstance for this office in the Army, and that he could count on new promotions as time went on. Douglas's brother, meanwhile, had accepted a commission at the U.S. Naval Academy, and with Arthur III now out of the picture and safely ensconced at Annapolis, Pinky could concentrate all her attention on her youngest son's scholastic attainments. Up until now, they had been pitiful. Later, Douglas confessed, I was only an average student at the various schools he had attended, including in Washington. Both his father and his mother shook their heads over his mediocre grades and wondered aloud why he couldn't be more like his brother Arthur, who was not only an excellent scholar, but also a brilliant athlete who broke the Annapolis record for the half-mile run. The place they chose for turning Douglas around was San Antonio's West Texas Military Academy. It had been founded in 1893 by the Right Reverend James Steptoe Johnson, a veteran of the 11th Mississippi during the Civil War, who fought in 12 engagements with the Army of Northern Virginia and believed that, in a military school, a boy most readily acquires the habits of neatness, attention, and obedience, and which tend to make one upright in principles and morals as well as in bearing. His other goal was to develop the Christian character amongst the rising generation, and to teach them that character is the only true wealth. In any case, it was an environment that had an almost miraculous impact on their youngest son's mind and spirit. A transformation began to take place in my development, he recorded 70 years later. There came a desire to know, a seeking for the reason why, a search for truth. His first year at West Texas, he maintained a 96.3 average out of 100 possible points, which dipped to 95.15 the following year. His third year brought a 97.65 average and a citation for superior excellence in scholarship. The boy whose main interest had been sports was given a medal for the highest average in mathematics. What had happened? The impact of a strong, disciplined atmosphere with a healthy competition from other students, many of whom came from the San Antonio area and were, in the words of one graduate, some of the meanest boys this side of hell, may have had something to do with it. The presence of strong-minded teachers and administrators like Reverend Johnson and Alan Burleson, the school's rector, probably helped. So did the hormonal boost of reaching the age when, as Dr. Johnson once said, the mind was most active and most retentive, and intellectual discovery becomes a thrill equal to scoring on the football field or, no doubt for some cadets, discovering girls. Another part of it may simply have been the absence of an older brother, who was accustomed to excelling and earning the approval of both parents, while his younger sibling was forced to sit and listen. Now, in the vacuum created by Arthur III's departure for Annapolis, Douglas finally had the chance to shine. Whatever the cause, he took full advantage of it. Abstruse mathematics began to appear as a challenge, he remembered later. Dull Latin and Greek seemed a gateway to the moving words of the leaders of the past. Laborious historical data led to the nerve-tingling battlefields of the great captains. Biblical lessons began to open the spiritual portals of a growing faith. Literature to lay bare the souls of men. As one of his awed classmates remembered, MacArthur was doing conic sections when the rest of us were struggling with elementary algebra. And another said, his ability to analyze a problem and arrive at a sound conclusion is just out of this world. At the same time, he was quarterback of the football team, played shortstop for the baseball team, which won 7 out of 8 games, and won the school's tennis championship. Douglas's transformation was a matter of family as well as personal pride. His grandfather, the judge, had authored 7 books. His father had built a library of nearly 4,000 volumes in everything from Chinese history to political economy. The MacArthur men admired intellectual attainment as much as winning on the battlefield or winning the presidency. And now Arthur MacArthur's youngest son, Pinky's darling baby, had earned his place in the same exalted company. At West Texas, he learned a lifelong love of books and ideas, and the mind that analyzed conic sections would later devote itself to organizing military operations from assaults on German positions on the Hindenburg Line to the liberation of the Philippines, and contemplating the logistics of nuclear war with Communist China. Looking back 6 decades later, he wrote, my 4 years there were the happiest of my life. Texas will always be a second home to me. Speaking of West Texas Military Academy to other graduates, he would always say, this is where I started. On June 8, 1897, his proud parents sat in the pew in the school chapel as Douglas MacArthur, class valedictorian, recited James Jeffrey Roach's stirring poem, The Fight of the General Armstrong. Their son had won the school's highest honor, the Academy Gold Medal, as well as medals in Latin, mathematics, and public speaking. Reverend Burleson told them Douglas was the most promising student that I have ever had in an experience of over 10 years in schools both North and South. Their lives had changed too. For the second time in his life, Arthur MacArthur was made Lieutenant Colonel. The first promotion had come at the end of the Civil War, when he was about to turn 20. The second came on June 8, 1896, 6 days after his 51st birthday. That same month, Arthur III graduated from Annapolis and set off for San Francisco as a cadet on the USS Philadelphia. Then, in August, Judge MacArthur died at a health clinic in Atlantic City. The Atlantic City Daily Press, the Atlantic City Daily Union, and the Milwaukee Sentinel all carried the news on their front pages. And his widow had conveyed the judge's body to be buried at Rock Creek Cemetery in Washington. 2 months later, in October 1896, Lieutenant Colonel Arthur MacArthur, with his father's death he had dropped the junior from his signature, was assigned as the new Adjutant General of the Department of the Dakotas, with headquarters in St. Paul, Minnesota. The young graduate from West Texas Military Academy would be headed back north with him, but not to St. Paul. He would be living in Milwaukee, where his father and mother had hatched a plan to get Douglas past the next set of hurdles so he could enter the United States Military Academy at West Point. What none of them could know was that in less than a year, events would disrupt all their plans, and a sudden explosion in Havana Harbor would change the destiny of the United States and that of the MacArthur family. I never worked harder in all my life. That was MacArthur's recollection many years later of the time he spent in the winter and spring of 1897 through 98, preparing for the next great hurdle he faced in his pursuit of a military career. Always before me was the goal of West Point, MacArthur wrote, the greatest military academy in the world. It had been his father's dream to attend, but he never did. Douglas tried to get an at-large appointment right after graduating from West Texas, but despite a sheaf of supporting letters from the commanding general of the Department of Texas, Wisconsin Senator John L. Mitchell, whose father had been one of the late Judge MacArthur's closest friends, four governors, two congressmen, and two bishops, President Grover Cleveland turned him down. He tried again later with the newly inaugurated President McKinley, but again the result was disappointment. Now his parents sprang into action. Arthur MacArthur once told one of his aides, the future Secretary of War, Peyton March, that he had started planning to get Douglas into West Point the day the boy was born. So he and Pinky devised what they considered a foolproof plan to get Douglas accepted, even though it had several moving parts. The goal was to secure his nomination to West Point by Wisconsin Representative Theobald Achin, yet another old friend of the late judge, by establishing residence in the congressman's district. They would do this by setting Douglas and his mother up in the swank Plankinton House Hotel in Milwaukee, where she could supervise his studies for the West Point entrance exam, while Arthur MacArthur would commute from St. Paul on weekends to see how things were progressing. In addition, Milwaukee was the home of a leading back specialist, Dr. Franz Pfister, who would treat the slight curvature of the spine that Douglas had developed at West Texas so that there could be no physical obstacles to his entering West Point. Douglas and his mother moved into Plankinton House in October 1897. They had 7 months before the competitive exam in May the following year. The schedule of study was unrelenting. In addition to his own course of reading under his mother's care, Douglas attended classes at Milwaukee's West Side High School to brush up on history, mathematics, English, and other topics covered in the exam. While the school's principal and its most popular history teacher, Miss Gertrude Hull, agreed to tutor the 18-year-old on whatever subjects posed the most difficult challenges. Monday through Friday, Douglas went through the same grinding routine of walking the 2 miles to West Side to get there ahead of other students, so he was already in class by the time they arrived, then returning home for more reading and study. On the weekends, however, there was time for church. He had been confirmed into the Episcopal Church while he was at West Texas, and for relaxation with his new Milwaukee friends. One was Frank McCutcheon, the assistant desk clerk at the Plankinton, with whom Douglas would sit and talk for hours, mostly about his dreams of a military career and joining the cavalry. Another was far more momentous for the future. The Mitchells, including Senator John L. Mitchell, had been MacArthur friends for decades. The senator had even served with Arthur MacArthur in the 24th Wisconsin. Douglas soon struck up an acquaintance with John Mitchell's son, William, as well as his sister. In fact, the sister was the object of Douglas's first teenage crush, and of the first lines of MacArthur poetry that survive. They are everything one would expect. Fair Western girl, with life a whirl, of love and fancy free. 'Tis thee I love, all things above. Why wilt thou not love me? Even after she read these lines, it seems she never did. Douglas and William Mitchell never became close. Indeed, Douglas must have looked up to the 20-something William, who was something of a local hero, and who in 1898 had already embarked on the military career that Douglas coveted for himself. But after serving in the Spanish-American War, William Billy Mitchell would choose military aviation as his field. He was destined to become the country's outspoken, if controversial, prophet of a new strategy for winning wars decisively, air power. Then, in 1928, he would be the subject of the most famous and significant court-martial in American history, one that would nearly doom America's ability to prepare for World War II. And on the opposite side of the court-martial table would be his old friend from Milwaukee, General Douglas MacArthur. As February 1898 dawned, and Milwaukee braced itself for one last bout of winter before the spring thaw, Douglas MacArthur and his mother were in the final stages of preparing him for the May competitive exam that would determine which prospective cadet got Congressman Ochin's nomination for West Point. Then one day, the headlines of the Milwaukee papers were filled with news from the Spanish colony of Cuba that would turn the MacArthur's lives and the country upside down. On the night of February 15th, a massive explosion ripped through the bowels of the battleship USS Maine as it was moored in Havana Harbor. It had been sent there to reassure American citizens in Cuba who were caught in the bloody war between the Spanish colonial government and Cuban nationalist guerrillas. Instead, the ship became the watery grave of 260 Americans. To this day, no one knows exactly what caused the Maine's 5 tons of powder charges to explode, blowing away the entire front third of the battleship. A hastily assembled American Court of Inquiry, however, decided it was a Spanish naval mine, perhaps deliberately set to deter the United States from intervening in the ongoing guerrilla war on the island. Spain's increasingly brutal counterinsurgent tactics, including confining thousands of Cubans in barbed wire-lined detention camps, had offended Americans' sense of fairness and decency. Many reading the sensational articles about Cuba in Joseph Pulitzer's New York World and William Hearst's New York Journal had wondered aloud what the Monroe Doctrine was for, except to prevent a European imperial power from committing atrocities on a new world nation yearning to be free. In March, as the death toll from the Maine disaster grew, the cry went up across America, "Remember the Maine! To hell with Spain!" There was a pro-war march through Milwaukee, which Douglas no doubt watched and may even have joined. The calls for retaliation echoed not only in the streets of Milwaukee, but in the halls of government and Congress as well. There, America's leading exponents of the expansionist foreign policy that Arthur MacArthur had prophesied 16 years earlier had been waiting for an opportunity like this one. They were led by Assistant Secretary of the Navy Theodore Roosevelt, as well as Secretary of State John Hay, and 2 senators from Massachusetts, Albert Beveridge and Henry Cabot Lodge. In their minds, it was time for the United States, the world's fastest-growing industrial power, to seize its rightful place on the world stage. They were more than willing to ride the outcry over the Maine to force a reluctant President McKinley to summon the nation to war, a war they were confident they could win. To this day, many historians, including most of MacArthur's biographers, have treated the rush to war in 1898 as a form of war hysteria, whipped up by a jingoistic press and fanned into flame by irresponsible politicians. In fact, motives for going to war were more complicated. They were a buoyant mixture of moral crusade and a belief in manifest destiny, weighed down by an additional calculation of realpolitik. If the United States didn't use this chance to grab off portions of a moribund Spanish empire in the New World as well as the Pacific, went the reasoning, some other European power, such as Germany, likely would. Besides, have we no mission to perform, no duty to discharge to our fellow man? Albert Beveridge proclaimed, unconsciously echoing Arthur MacArthur's words of a decade and a half earlier. Shall America continue its march toward commercial supremacy over the world? Shall free institutions broaden their reign as the children of liberty wax in strength, until the empire of our principles shall be established over the hearts of all mankind? Despite the wave of moral fervor in the media and in influential circles, it took almost 2 months for war to be declared. When it came on April 20th, Arthur MacArthur immediately got in touch with his friend Major General Henry Clark Corbin, the Army's adjutant general, to ask for a combat command, his first since the Civil War 27 years before. He knew that an army that had barely numbered 30,000 troops when the Maine was sunk would now have 125,000 volunteers to train and equip, a number that would swell to 250,000 the next year. The Army was going to need every experienced field commander it could muster, and MacArthur was determined to be at the head of the line. Corbin gave him what he wanted. Colonel Arthur MacArthur was ordered to report to Camp Thomas at Chickamauga, Georgia, ironically the scene of the old 24th Wisconsin's bloodiest fight, to assemble and train a brigade of volunteers as part of Three Corps' invasion of Cuba while taking the rank of brigadier general. But then events on the other side of the world intervened. The first shots in the war with Spain were fired not in Cuba, but across the Pacific, in the old Spanish colony of the Philippines. Theodore Roosevelt's plan for mobilizing the Navy for war had included dispatching the U.S. Asiatic Fleet under Admiral George Dewey to Manila to attack the Spanish fleet there. On May 1st, Dewey's fleet struck with devastating and decisive force, sinking all but one of Spain's older undergunned warships. Total U.S. casualties came to 9 wounded and 1 dead from heat stroke. In the course of a single day, the way had opened for an American incursion into another Spanish colony, the Philippines. As it happened, like Cuba, the islands were home to another anti-Spanish insurgency. This one was led by a 27-year-old former provincial mayor named Emilio Aguinaldo, who had been in exile in Hong Kong when he learned the news of Dewey's stunning victory. Aguinaldo immediately set out to return home, where he soon upset all of America's plans for the Philippines. Meanwhile, Three Corps had set sail for Cuba in June. MacArthur, however, was not with them. Instead, he had been assigned to San Francisco to take command of the 1st Brigade, 1st Division, under the overall command of General Wesley Merritt. As they embarked for the Philippines on August 4th, he was not the only MacArthur caught up in the war. The newly minted brigadier general had learned that his son Arthur was on his way to Cuba as part of the naval expedition that would eventually sink another Spanish fleet at Santiago on July the 3rd. But that was not all. General MacArthur had also received a letter from his wife informing him, to his pride and delight, that their other son, Douglas, was on his way to West Point. Douglas was making final preparations for the all-important West Point exam when the war broke out in April. Still, he and his friend Frank McCutcheon thought seriously of volunteering to join the fight. But in the end, he did not dare. He and his mother and father had invested too much in passing the exam in May, and so he was forced to follow the course of the war in the newspapers until he finished the final round of study closed the last book, and waited for the exam the next day at Milwaukee's City Hall. Sleep was impossible that night. The expectations of the entire MacArthur family, father, mother, older brother, the memory of his grandfather, seemed to weigh him down as he tossed and turned in bed. The next day, on the way to the City Hall, he felt tired, haggard, and half-defeated. He was also deeply nauseous, he writes in his memoirs, a nervous reaction that would haunt him in later moments of stress and indecision as well. It was his mother, he remembered, who turned him around. "Doug," she said, tugging on his sleeve, "you'll win if you don't lose your nerve. You must believe in yourself, my son, or no one else will believe in you." Her final words of advice before he entered the exam room were, "Be self-confident, self-reliant, and even if you don't make it," Douglas must have drawn a sharp breath as she said it, "you will know you have done your best. Now go to it." He did. When he left the examination room, he had scored 93.3 out of a possible 100, 16 points ahead of the next applicant. When the results were announced in June, Douglas had won the congressional appointment. "It was a lesson I never forgot," he wrote. "Preparedness is the key to success and victory." It also taught him that whatever his doubts and insecurities, and however distant his father seemed in both emotional and physical terms, his mother would be his pillar and rock, the one who would stand by him no matter what, and would believe in him when others did not. It's no wonder, then, that when he finally stepped off the coach of the West Shore Railroad at the stop for West Point, New York, in early June 1899, and saw the cold, gray granite buildings of the U.S. Military Academy for the first time, his mother was with him, and that she would be with him every single day for the next 2 years at the Academy. She did not, of course, live on the grounds of the academy or in the dorm where Cadet Douglas MacArthur was housed. She took a room at the West Point Hotel, a broken-down boarding house on the northern edge of the West Point Plain. Pinky did not mind the shoddy rooms or the dirty facilities. She would be only a couple of hundred yards away from her son as he embarked on what was so far the greatest adventure of his life. Physically, he was more than prepared for what was coming. He was now 19 years and 4 months old. His slight spinal curvature had been cured. He stood 5 feet 10 inches tall and weighed 133 pounds. His physical report the day he registered pronounced him normal. A member of his class, Cadet Hugh Johnson, later head of the National Recovery Administration under Franklin Roosevelt, called him the handsomest young man I have ever seen. Mentally and spiritually, though, there were serious challenges ahead. One was that West Point was a closed world in more ways than one. A member of the Cadet Corps was allowed off the post exactly twice a year, once for the Army-Navy game, and once for summer furlough at the end of the term year. Christmas never interrupted the regular routine of the Corps, let alone Thanksgiving. A cadet who left sight of the Academy buildings was not allowed to dismount until he returned. He was not even allowed to handle money. Winston Churchill, who served with the 4th Hussars Cavalry Regiment, no slouch in discipline, noted that West Point cadets were cloistered almost to a monastic degree, hence the Academy's nickname, Monastery on the Hudson. A new cadet was also plunged into a world with its own language. A demerit was a quill, because long ago a goose feather quill had been used to record them. A reprimand that required walking post was a slug. Milk in the mess hall was cow, and cream was calf. A plebe assigned to carve meat for upperclassmen was a gunner. First-year cadets, like MacArthur, were plebes, sophomores were yearlings, and juniors were second-classmen. A senior was a first-classman, and his female date a drag, and roommates at the academy were wives. The physical conditions in which plebes lived were grim. Not much had changed since the institution had opened almost 100 years before. The plumbing and standard of sanitation was ancient. The food was meant to sustain, not satisfy. And lights out at night was at 10 o'clock. But the real test, starting in July and August, in what was known as beast barracks, was the hazing. It was an ancient ritual harking back to militaristic societies like the Spartans, and revered by every cadet who experienced it and survived to mete it out to others. Those living outside the monastery on the Hudson saw it as brutal bullying, pure and simple. Cadets, alumni, and even professors understood it to be a necessary ritual for shaping a common esprit de corps and weeding out the unsuitable. By the time Douglas arrived, however, the hazing rituals had reached new levels of absurdity, even lethality, and he would become a principal target. By West Point standards, it was easy to see why. Having his mother on hand did not help. The grandson of another Army legend, U.S. Grant, was a member of the same West Point class, and his mother, too, kept rooms at the West Point Hotel. Word quickly spread that both were Mama's boys, which brought the same malignant attention to Ulysses III from other cadets that Douglas had to endure. But Douglas's problems also stemmed from his father. That summer, Arthur MacArthur was fast becoming an Army legend, not just for his Civil War exploits. Southern upperclassmen enjoyed making plebe Arthur recite every detail of his father's campaigns, but for his growing success in the fighting in the Philippines. Chapter 3. Glory Days. A quote from Arthur MacArthur, 1899. The planting of liberty, not money, is what we seek. The human race has propagated its highest ideals in a succession of waves, and now its waves are passing beyond the Pacific. As Arthur MacArthur and the five transports carrying the men of his 1st Brigade steamed into Manila Harbor on the morning of July 31st, 1898, a strange sight greeted them. It was a long and dismal row of smokestacks sticking up from the water outside Cavite, the old Spanish naval base. It was all that remained of the Spanish fleet Admiral Dewey had sent to the bottom of the harbor on May 1st, and the stunning victory that had left the Philippines open to the Americans, along with everyone else. As the transports approached Manila, MacArthur and his men realized the Americans were far from alone. 50 warships of 4 other nations, Britain, France, Germany, and Russia, filled the harbor, a veritable forest of masts and smokestacks, while Admiral Dewey's flagship, Olympia, and the other vessels of the American fleet watched them warily. For MacArthur, the message was clear. If the Americans failed to fill the vacuum left by the defeat of Spanish colonial rule in the Philippines, others would fill it for them. Admiral George Dewey, meanwhile, had other problems on his mind. Following his smashing victory at Manila Bay, he had arranged for the young leader of the Filipino rebels, Aguinaldo, to leave his exile in Hong Kong and come to Manila. They had met on May 19th, and to this day no one can agree on what they said to each other. Aguinaldo would later insist that Dewey supported his nation's claim for independence. Dewey would insist just as strongly he had said nothing of the sort. In his mind, his task was still to defeat the Spanish. What happened to the country afterward was none of his business, including its possible independence. There was a huge problem, however. Although Dewey had told MacArthur and General Merritt, the overall commander, to take no notice of the insurgents as the Americans prepared to take Manila, the insurgents now controlled virtually all of the Philippines except Manila. In fact, on June 12th, the very day MacArthur had left for San Francisco to join his command, Aguinaldo stole a march on Dewey and everyone else by formally declaring his country's independence. Indeed, forces were unfolding in the Philippines that first MacArthur and then, more than 30 years later, his son would try to cajole, nudge, and bring into the American camp. It would be the same problem that would bedevil American policymakers in Vietnam, Iraq, and Afghanistan. How to unlock a people's desire to be free by force without having them turn back on their liberators? The Filipino rebels were at first welcoming of their American liberators. The 15,000 men in the Spanish garrison in Manila were far more willing to surrender to the Americans than to the Filipinos, who could be expected to seek revenge for Spanish atrocities during the years of insurgency. After some light resistance, American troops entered Manila to accept the Spanish commander's surrender on August 13, 1898. MacArthur and his men breathed a sigh of relief. The streets of the old city, known as the Intramuros, wound themselves into a labyrinth of alleys and passages, many of which were so narrow that a man had to hug the stone walls to let another person pass. If the Spaniards had decided to fight house to house there, it could have taken days, even weeks, to winkle them out. The result would have been massive American casualties, as his son Douglas would discover almost half a century later. A few weeks passed before MacArthur and Merritt learned that the war in Cuba was over, following Theodore Roosevelt's stunning victory at San Juan Hill, that more American troops would be coming to the Philippines under General Elwell E. Otis, and that Arthur MacArthur and General Thomas Anderson would assume command of Otis's two divisions, some 20,000 men. That fall, under American occupation, Manila enjoyed the coming of peace. Martial law was lifted, and MacArthur was now commanding a division of more than 9,000 men, with more reinforcements on the way. He was going to need them. On December 11th, news came over the restored telegraph that President McKinley had decided, after considerable hesitation and second-guessing as well as prayer, that the United States would annex the Philippines rather than grant the islands outright independence. Independence, without the means to safeguard it, some argued, would only leave the islands exposed to colonization by Germany, Britain, or France. Annexation by America was really the best solution. That feeling did not extend to the Philippine insurgents. Overnight, McKinley's fateful decision turned Aguinaldo and the Filipino National Army from allies into enemies. And on the night of February 4, 1899, fighting broke out between a sentry of the 1st Nebraska Volunteers and Filipino troops. America's first land war in Asia had begun. Arthur MacArthur would distinguish himself in the fighting to clear the rebels from Manila and to drive them north, finally capturing Aguinaldo's capital at Malolos, 20 miles north of Manila. By May, he was a national hero. Newspapers proclaimed, "'Tis Dewey on the sea and MacArthur on the land." But as the spring of 1899 dissolved into summer, an American army already weakened thanks to the exit of thousands of volunteers as their term of enlistment came due, and they boarded ships for home, was weakened further by the outbreak of diseases like typhus, dysentery, and yellow fever. Aguinaldo, in the meantime, refused to surrender. We are no nearer a conclusion of hostilities here than we were 3 months ago, one officer wrote home to his wife on June 15th. As the summer dragged on, Arthur MacArthur would have had to agree. They were going to need a lot more troops and a much more aggressive commander than General Otis if they were going to win this war. Meanwhile, Douglas's personal battle with hazing at West Point was reaching a climax. Ordinarily, a cadet could escape the torture of hazing only by agreeing to a knockdown bare-knuckle fight with a skilled upperclassman, which usually left the plebe unconscious and bleeding. MacArthur was a skilled boxer, but he resigned himself to the hazing regime. We always prepared a warm reception for the sons of well-known men, said Robert Wood, later a close friend of Douglas MacArthur and CEO of Sears Roebuck, and he was not kidding. Being forced to recite his father's military records and making funny speeches, or hanging by his toes and fingers from a cot until he dropped from exhaustion, were just the start. Douglas MacArthur took all the hazing with fortitude and dignity, Wood remembered, even after upperclassmen gave him a sweat bath by putting him in full dress uniform, wrapping him in a blanket and a raincoat, and making him sit up all night in the middle of summer. The turning point came one night when a gang of cadets led him blindfolded into a darkened tent, stripped him stark naked, and ordered him to do 250 spread eagles, meaning standing on his toes with arms extended, dropping to a stoop, flapping his arms and rising to a sitting position, then doing it again, over a bed of broken glass, followed by wooden willies that involved holding the regulation rifle at a fire position, dropping down to reload at the order of ready, and then repeating the exercise until the upperclassmen decided to call it quits. Douglas passed out before they called it quits. When they revived him, he went into severe convulsions, with arms and legs jerking uncontrollably. He was still in convulsions when they carried him back to his room, where he asked his roommate to throw a blanket under his feet so that their involuntary thudding wouldn't alert the company officers to what had happened, and to jam a blanket in his mouth in case he cried out in pain. The next morning, Douglas refused to go on sick report, as some urged him to do, or to speak about the incident. He turned out for drill and other duties like the other cadets, but when he was returning to his tent, he was stopped by an upperclassman, the same one who had led the hazing the night before. The man was ashamed about what had happened, but he also had a message. "By your plucky work last night," he told MacArthur, "you have a bootlick from the entire corps." A bootlick meant he had earned the respect of every cadet at West Point for his endurance and for keeping his mouth shut. It meant an end to hazing for Douglas MacArthur and a new prestige among his fellow cadets. In short, he emerged from camp with flying colors. He showed himself a true soldier, a colleague remembered. Others, however, took a very different view of things. When a cadet named Oscar L. Booz died as a result of hazing by members of MacArthur's class, the McKinley administration launched a formal inquiry, while a special committee of the House of Representatives decided to hold an investigative hearing. One of the former victims of hazing they particularly wanted to hear from was Cadet Douglas MacArthur. MacArthur was in a quandary. On the one hand, he couldn't snitch on former classmates. "Come what may," he wrote later, "I would be no tattletale." On the other, he couldn't lie to the court of inquiry. He had already been summoned to the superintendent's office to name his original tormentors, and he had refused. If McKinley's special court of inquiry demanded the offenders' names, and if MacArthur refused again, it would in all likelihood mean my dismissal and the end of all my hopes and dreams. Instead, it would be so easy and expedient to yield, to tell. And who would blame me? The answer, of course, was himself. The date was December 1900. Far away in the Philippines, his father's war with insurgents after a year and a half had taken a strange but decisive turn. Step by step, battle by battle, the Americans had finally cleared out resistance from the island of Luzon and broken the back of the Philippine National Army. With the rebel forces destroyed, General Otis and other officers assumed the war was over. Arthur MacArthur, however, did not. He grimly predicted that the insurgency was about to make a comeback. He also knew that the Americans had made themselves deeply unpopular in the Philippines, and that unless they wrapped up the war quickly, this could turn into a protracted, costly stalemate, what a later generation would call a quagmire. Starting in January, the quagmire revealed itself. American control of Luzon steadily deteriorated. The number of engagements, always with small bands of hit-and-run partisans, rose, as did the number of American casualties. As in all guerrilla wars, the conduct of the war grew progressively more vicious, with each side taking the opportunity of atrocities by the other side to commit atrocities of its own. Finally, Washington had had enough, and in March 1900 replaced Otis with Arthur MacArthur. At the same time, it appointed MacArthur military governor of the Philippines. The news left Aguinaldo and his guerrillas deeply worried. They knew who they would be dealing with. One of their leaders admitted MacArthur was the most able American general. They sensed the war was going to take a much tougher turn. They were right. MacArthur now had some 70,000 troops under his command, two-thirds of the entire U.S. Army, plus auxiliary units of Philippine ethnic minorities like the Macabebes and Ilocanos, who hated the majority Tagalogs leading the insurgency. MacArthur was ready to take the fight directly to the enemy. From December 1899 to September 1900, the U.S. Army fought more skirmishes with Filipino guerrillas and suffered more casualties, well over 1,000, than it had in every Indian war since 1865. Officials in Washington and the public were horrified. But as America's first great counterinsurgency strategist, the predecessor of future theorists such as David Petraeus and David Galula, MacArthur understood that the mounting casualties were the price of future success. The goal was to push the insurgents off to the margins, deeper and deeper into the mountains and the jungle, while isolating them from the larger population. That population, he believed, was now united in its support of the revolutionaries. That such unity exists is an undeniable fact, he wrote, whatever journalists and propagandists in Washington might think, along with Washington's sanguine emissary, William Howard Taft, who arrived in June 1900 convinced that the fighting was all but over. MacArthur knew better. Victory would come, he believed, only after the majority of Filipinos finally decided that resistance to American occupation was futile, and that supporting the occupation could even be beneficial. That was what he set out to do as military governor, a job combining economist, political theorist, civil engineer, business executive, and secondary school teacher all in one. Fortunately, Arthur MacArthur was prepared for all of them. From his headquarters in Manila, he and his staff worked long days that dragged on through dinner, discussing problems in sanitation, education, economic development, and civil administration as well as the war. He also appointed boards of officers to study key issues like land reform, while he put soldiers to building schools, vaccinating civilians, setting up courts run by Filipino judges in pacified areas, and making sure municipal elections were safe and fair, much as his son would do in occupied Japan, and American soldiers would do in Iraq and Afghanistan more than a century later. In the meantime, however, there was still a war to win. In December 1900, even as his son Douglas was about to be called as witness for the president's hazing investigation, Arthur MacArthur declared martial law throughout the Philippines. He applied a general order that President Lincoln had issued during the Civil War and General Sherman had used during his march through Georgia, declaring that combatants who were not in uniform and civilians who helped them would be subject to the death penalty. He also ordered 39 prominent insurrection leaders to be interned in Guam and had their property seized, including Aguinaldo's. "Either you're for us or you're against us," MacArthur was saying to the Philippine elites. Despite Taft's misgivings, the strategy worked. Insurgents began to surrender to their American pursuers. Public support for the insurrection weakened. The final stroke came in March 1901, when, by a simple ruse, MacArthur was able to arrange for the capture of the Filipino leader Aguinaldo himself. That, combined with MacArthur's internment of key figures of the Filipino establishment, finally snapped the spine of the Filipino insurgency. On April 19th, after 3 weeks of intense negotiation, Aguinaldo, pressured by family and friends, threw in the towel. He agreed to swear allegiance to the United States and call on his followers to surrender in exchange for the immediate release of 1,000 prisoners, another 1,000 in May, and a further 1,000 a month later. Except for a few hot spots like Batangas Province, south of Manila, and the island of Samar, the insurgency collapsed. As Arthur MacArthur sailed back to San Francisco on July 2, 1901, he could be satisfied with the outcome. He was now a major general. He had decisively won the most extensive guerrilla war that any Western nation, let alone the United States, had ever faced. He also had won the respect, even adoration, of a generation of American soldiers for whom he was, by general consent, the finest officer with whom they had ever served. He had missed shaping his son Douglas's years at West Point, but he would leave him a far more valuable gift. This was that a number of the officers under whom Douglas would serve, Peyton March, Frederick Funston, John J. Pershing, Charles Summerall, would have earned their spurs in the Philippines under his father's command. The trust and respect they felt for the father would transfer when they took over command of the son, as all of them did. Some would be protective. Most, like Funston and Summerall, would be tough but fair. John J. Blackjack Pershing would be brutal. But all of them would remember the general who stood tall under enemy fire in the Philippines and found a way to win a war that most had thought unwinnable. Whatever Douglas's occasional flaws, they would give him the benefit of the doubt because they remembered the MacArthur who had risked everything to save his country from the humiliation of defeat and gave his soldiers the prize they most craved, final victory. The day the anti-hazing court met, Douglas MacArthur felt desperately ill. Again, the paralyzing nausea that almost overwhelmed him the day of his qualifying exam in Milwaukee. And again, it was his mother who came to his rescue. From the West Point Hotel, she sent him a letter. He opened it during a recess in the court, he tells us, and inside he found a poem. "Do you know that your soul is my soul, such a part? that you seem to be fiber and core of my heart? None other can pain me as you, son, can do. None other can please me or praise me as you. Remember, the world will be quick with its blame if shadow or shame ever darken your name. Like mother, like son, is saying so true, the world will judge largely of mother by you. MacArthur read the last four lines with tears in his eyes. Be this your task, if task it shall be, to force this proud world to do homage to me. Be sure it will say when its verdict you've won, she reaps as she sowed, this man is her son. With the poem folded in his pocket, MacArthur strode into the courtroom. I can still feel the beads of sweat on my brow, he wrote 60 years later. I still feel my knees giving way under me in that dreadful nausea. I did my best to fend off the questions, to dodge the issues, but the judges, all retired military men, refused to be put off. They ordered him to divulge the names of his hazers. I pleaded for mercy, that my whole life's hope lay in being an officer, that always I had been with the colors, that my father, then on the battle line 10,000 miles away, was their comrade in arms of the Civil War and Indian Wars, that I would do anything in the way of punishment, but not to strip me of my uniform. There was a pause, and then the head of the court said, Court is recessed. Take him to his quarters. Back in his room, Douglas MacArthur waited all day to be put under arrest. But the order never came. They were not about to arrest or expel the son of Arthur MacArthur, the hero of the Philippines. They found other ways of getting the names they wanted. When Douglas had to appear before the congressional committee, the questioning was more grueling. You do not look very robust now, one congressman remarked sarcastically when MacArthur said having to endure the hours of spread eagles hadn't done him any lasting physical harm. But in a sense, it was anticlimactic. The congressman now had the names. What they really wanted was Cadet MacArthur to condemn hazing as a ritual institution. This he adamantly refused to do. Question. Did you consider it cruel at the time? Answer. I would like to have you define cruel. Question. All right, sir. Disposed to inflict suffering. Indifference in the presence of suffering. Hard-hearted. Inflicting pain mentally or physically. Answer. I should say perhaps it was cruel then. Question. You have qualified your answer. Was it or was it not cruel? Answer. Yes, sir. Question. And you did not expect it was part of the essential education of an officer to be subjected to such cruelty? Answer. I do not think it is essential. No, sir. But was it cruelty? Decades later, MacArthur still refused to see the hazing itself as anything but a natural part of how West Point shaped the character of its cadets to deal with adversity. How to uphold the solidarity of the Corps. How to endure and get rid of those who couldn't take it. Hazing was practiced with a worthy goal, he would write later, but sometimes with methods that were violent and uncontrolled. The answer was regulation, not abolition. He was not alone. John J. Pershing, who had been a vigorous, even hated tactical officer, at West Point 2 years before MacArthur arrived, cadets called him Lord God Almighty, had been an enthusiastic hazer as an upperclassman, and did nothing to stop it during his time as tech. He once told a friend, "I hope the day will never come when hazing is abolished." MacArthur would have had to agree. The investigations had come as Douglas MacArthur was in his third year as a cadet. He had already proved himself to be one of the best in West Point's history. As someone who served 3 years with him at the academy put it, there was never another cadet quite like him. Photographs in his cadet uniform show him poised and confident, with strikingly handsome, almost beautiful good looks. Another reason he may have been a target for hazing early on. There's also a slightly faraway visionary cast to his eyes that's familiar from myriad photographs of him during World War II in Korea. That's no coincidence. The years at West Point created the essential core of the Douglas MacArthur the world would know for the rest of his life. The framework of values, habits, and attitudes that would sustain him for the next half century. "Think of the sort of man he is today," his former West Point roommate said in 1953, "and you have exactly the picture of what he was when he graduated in 1903. One of those values was his love of the army, which bordered on religious idolatry. The barracks and facilities at West Point were broken down, unsanitary, and squalid. Two cadets shared a room with barely enough space for one of them to stand. There was no electricity, no running water. Instead, cadets had to fetch any water they needed with a 5-gallon metal bucket from an outside spigot. From reveille at 6 a.m. until mandatory lights out for underclassmen at 10 p.m., every day was a regimented routine of drill, classes, inspections, and parades. Yet MacArthur was enchanted by it. To be in the same rooms, walk down the same halls, and attend the same classes, sometimes the same lectures, as Robert E. Lee, class of 1829. Ulysses S. Grant, class of 1843, Phil Sheridan, class of 1853, Jeb Stuart, class of 1854, George Armstrong Custer, class of 1861, and nearly every successful general currently serving in the Army except his father was sometimes overwhelming. As an army brat, it was the fulfillment of all my boyish dreams," he wrote in 1947. "The pride and thrill of being a West Pointer has never dimmed." To be part of West Point was to be part of history, but it was also a responsibility. "You are the leaven which binds together the entire fabric of our national defense," he once told a class of graduating cadets. "From your ranks come the great captains who hold the nation's destiny in their hands the moment the war tocsin sounds. The long gray line has never failed us, and he would never fail the Corps and what it stood for." He had arrived at West Point determined not just to succeed, but to surpass every one of his classmates in everything. And he nearly did. "He was one of the hardest working men I've ever known," his first roommate remembered. "His every energy was directed toward the attainment of number one in his class." He was helped in this by the fact that his first roommate was also an upperclassman who had been impressed by MacArthur's drive and dedication the first time he set eyes on him during Beast Barracks and invited him to be his roommate. That was a lucky break for Douglas, because first classmen had the privilege of keeping their lights on until 11 p.m., which for Douglas meant a precious extra hour of study. He was also regularly up an hour before reveille, hitting the books in everything from chemistry, physics, and mathematics, the mainstays of the curriculum at the point, to geology, history, French, and Spanish. introduced after the start of the Spanish-American War. The teaching was perfunctory. None of the instructors in French, for example, could speak the language. Instead, cadets learned to prepare their lessons themselves, then come to class and recite the answers to questions instructors had assigned them during the previous class. It wasn't an educational system designed to bring out much original thinking or creativity, but it gave a student like MacArthur, who possessed a virtual photographic memory and intense self-discipline, a guaranteed head start over students who were less responsive to rote memorization and didn't take books all that seriously. But Douglas did, and by June 1900, of the 134 cadets still in his class, he was first in math, first in English, first in drill regulations, and first on the Order of General Merit. Nor were his accomplishments limited to the classroom. He also worked hard at sports at the point, starting with playing left field for the baseball team. "I was far from a brilliant ball player," he admitted years later. "I was no Ty Cobb, but in those days I could run." And as a classmate noted, he always managed to find a way to get on base either by drawing a walk or bunting his way to first. He managed to score the winning run in the very first Army-Navy baseball game at Annapolis on May 18, 1901, earning him a dark blue letter A, which he wore first on a sweater and then on a succession of gray dressing gowns for the rest of his life. What stood out in his mind 60 years later was not so much the score of the game, but the raucous song the Navy cadets sang to him as he and the rest of the Army players walked onto the field. "Are you the Governor General or a hobo? Who is the boss of this show? Is it you or Emilio Aguinaldo?" Yet it was from his father's years in the Philippines that Douglas MacArthur would draw valuable lessons for his own future, fighting in foreign lands. The first lesson was that politicians in Washington and their emissaries, like William Howard Taft, never understood the real situation on the ground in making policy, and so most of their recommendations are grounded in ignorance or bias, or both. The second was that when an American army finds itself occupying a foreign country against its will, the best initial policy is a fierce severity. "You can't put down a rebellion," wrote Major General Lord Wheaton in 1900, "by throwing confetti and sprinkling perfumery. The severity, however, must be followed by mercy and a generosity that throws opponents off balance and points the way to a lasting peace." Finally, Arthur MacArthur taught his son that America's role in Asia was different from those of other Western nations who were busy seizing trade concessions and colonies. It was to lend the light of liberty to people who had never experienced its warm, comforting glow, and to make America the symbol of freedom in a world that at times seemed to put a premium on its opposite. Upon his return to the United States, Arthur MacArthur was ordered to appear before Congress. Representatives, especially on the Democratic side, were outraged by reported atrocities by American troops. Arthur MacArthur deftly parried the attacks and criticism. He admitted that some individuals may have committed outrages, but said, "I doubt that any war, either international or civil, any war on earth, has been conducted with as much humanity, with as much careful consideration, with as much self-restraint, as have the American operations in the Philippine archipelago." He also spoke highly of the Filipinos. "They like our institutions," he told the senators. "They have some mistrust of us individually because our deportment is so entirely different. But I have a good deal of faith in them. They are smart, generous, and intelligent people. I do not think there is a question about the power of the Filipino to reach any standard of excellence in almost any direction. Then he finished by lecturing the senators on the importance of a continuing American presence in the Philippines, saying, "The archipelago's strategical position is unexcelled by that of any other position on the globe. It is relatively better placed than Japan, likewise India. It affords a means of protecting American interest, which, with the least output of physical power, has the effect of a commanding position. It is the stepping stone to commanding influence, political, commercial, and military supremacy in the East." It was a view his son would inherit and uphold for the rest of his life. The son, meanwhile, had created at West Point a record that was nothing less than astonishing. Douglas MacArthur would rank first in his class for 3 of his 4 years, dropping to 4th in his 3rd year, but still in the top 5 distinguished cadets. When he graduated in 1903, the gap between MacArthur's merits total, 2,424 out of a possible 2,470, or 98%, and that of the runner-up, Cadet Charles T. Leeds, was bigger than the gap separating Leeds from the man in 5th place. In addition to being the class first captain, he led his class in mathematics, English, drill regulations, history, ordnance and gunnery, law, and military efficiency. His scores in English, history, and law were perfect, 100% of all possible merits. Some said it was the most outstanding graduating record since Robert E. Lee's in the class of 1829. Most agreed it was the best in a quarter century. But for Douglas, the highest reward was having both his parents present for the graduation ceremony on June 11, 1903. There was his father, Arthur, fresh from his triumphs in the Philippines, and his mother, Mary, with whom he spent a half hour every afternoon during the 2 years she had been with him at West Point, discussing his studies, his hopes, his problems. The person who had been his emotional rock in the most trying times of his life. At West Point, he had learned the power of self-discipline and of self-assertion. It was customary in a cadet's last year that he could be exempted from taking the final exam in mathematics if he had maintained a certain grade point average. When Douglas saw his name on the list of cadets who were not exempt, because the teacher insisted that he had missed a single quiz, he exploded. He told his instructor point blank that he wouldn't take the exam no matter what. "If my name is not off that list before 9 a.m. in the morning," he told his roommate at the time, George Koshu, "I'll resign." Koshu winced. "But what will your father say?" "He will be terribly disappointed, but I believe he will see my attitude in the matter and approve my action." At 8:50, MacArthur got the news. The instructor had relented. He also got his first experience in leadership. Even during summer camp of his 1st year, older cadets recognized that this was a person born to be in charge. In his 2nd year, the tactical officer of A Company, an artillery officer, watched MacArthur drill a squad of inexperienced plebes. The officer turned to the cadet next to him and said with astonishment, "That's the finest drill master I have ever seen." At this point, his identification with his father was total. His roommate, Arthur Hyde, remembered Douglas being obsessed with measuring up to his father's standard. He often wondered if he would be as great a man as his father, and thought if hard work would make him so, he had a chance. His years at West Point seemed to prove him right. But it was his mother, Mary, who had enabled him first to take on and then endure the most difficult of all the crises that he underwent at the Point. In the end, it was her trust and approval, even more than his father's, that would serve as the emotional foundation for his career and future. His longtime aide and friend, Brigadier General Tommy Davis, who worked with him in the 20s and 30s, grasped this essential truth about the commanding officer whom he deeply admired but also understood. The goal instilled in him was to be Superman, was how Davis explained it to a colleague. MacArthur's tie to his mother represented possessiveness and dominance, with the son never free of an imposed destiny or from fear of failing it. Although the career he had chosen was his father's and his goals the same as his, it was his mother who shaped the ways in which he would achieve those goals, starting at West Point. For all these reasons, it was no wonder he could tell his roommate, "Next to my family, I love West Point," and tell the assembled cadets on the plane 55 years later in his last public speech, "When I cross the river, my last conscious thoughts will be of the Corps, and the Corps, and the Corps." It was a sincere declaration of what the Academy had meant to him, but also what it had enabled him to become. Chapter 4. Young Man Going East. A quote from Arthur MacArthur, Chinese Memorandum, 1882. "Asia is now the land of commerce, where the heated imagination can indulge the boldest assumptions, since it is essentially an unknown country." To a person just graduating from college, the world can seem a place of almost unlimited possibilities, or a place from which to seek permanent refuge. The first was true of Douglas MacArthur, and with good reason. After graduation from West Point, he enjoyed a 2-month furlough with his parents in San Francisco before starting on his first assignment as a second lieutenant of engineers. Douglas had learned he would be heading to the country that his father had just left, the Philippines, in order to join the 3rd Engineer Battalion. Now he would have a chance to see firsthand what his father had wrought in his 4 years as military governor there. The son would also start to forge his own links with the people and nation with whom he would be identified more than with any other country, including his own. But before he left, the young West Point graduate spent many hours listening to his father explain his view that the Filipinos were America's future friends in Asia. Douglas would often spend the day in General MacArthur's San Francisco office, now that his father was commander of the Division of the Pacific. Later, the son would remember hearing Arthur MacArthur explain both to the state's governor and to railroad baron E.H. Harriman his idea of creating an artificial harbor in Los Angeles. It was his belief that within 50 years such a port would become one of the leading handlers of commerce in the country, the Sun wrote, including trade with Asia. Creating a major Western hub for American-Asian trade was yet another dream Arthur MacArthur had outlined in his Chinese Memorandum 20 years earlier, a dream that would be realized with the creation of the Port of Los Angeles. "It's a very fortunate second lieutenant who has the opportunity to be briefed on the country where he is about to do a duty tour by the country's former military governor." Certainly, it was a well-informed Douglas MacArthur who set sail on the Army transport Sherman from San Francisco with his fellow engineers for his first encounter with Asia and the Far East. On October 28, 1903, MacArthur and the Sherman sailed into the blue-green expanse of Manila Bay. What impressed Douglas about Manila Bay, compared to San Francisco Bay, was its immense size. It measured 35 miles at its mouth, and the Sherman had to steam northeast for another 5 hours before it reached Manila. On the way, they passed a sinister-looking rock-bound island that the Spanish had dubbed Corregidor, which was used as a fortress to guard the bay. Looming behind the island were the forbidding headlands of the Bataan Peninsula, sticking out like a swollen thumb to the west of Manila. The Sherman was too large to unload at the Manila dock, so the big transport anchored offshore to discharge her passengers and cargo. From the deck, the young lieutenant could see the red-tiled roofs of the old city, set in a low, flat plain, with row upon row of nipa huts stretching out from the city's suburbs into the interior of Luzon. Small skiffs, or bancas, rowed up with Filipinos offering goods and services to the disembarking Americans. And in a couple of hours, Douglas MacArthur found himself wandering the streets of Manila, especially those of the 16th-century city nestled inside the old city walls, intramuros, with access through drawbridges over the surrounding moat like a fairy tale castle. This was not his father's Manila of 2 years earlier, where tense patrols of American troops passed through streets lined with burned-out houses from the siege, as Dewey's cruisers grimly guarded the harbor with their guns pointed toward shore. The city had almost returned to its normal peacetime routines, although there was still guerrilla fighting up in the Sierra Madre and on the remoter islands. Shops, restaurants, and cafes catered to Americans and Filipinos alike, while after a leisurely lunch, everything came to a halt for the two-hour siesta until 4 p.m. "The Philippines charmed me at first sight," MacArthur admitted years later. "But there wasn't a lot of time to enjoy the delights of the city. Almost the moment he docked, he was ordered to leave immediately for Iloilo on the island of Panay, where he would join the 3rd Engineer Battalion's I Company. The engineers were there to construct a new wharf and harbor for what was known as Camp Jossman, as part of the growing post-war American buildup in the islands. He found life on the island amazingly primitive and amazingly hot, even for November. But Panay was also amazingly beautiful, with the rich tropical foliage and sparkling emerald-green vistas set against the cobalt blue of the sea. There was also danger on Panay, MacArthur discovered, from poisonous snakes and the ever-present threat of malaria and yellow fever, but also from roaming gangs of brigands left over from Aguinaldo's army. Every outing from Camp Jossman into the jungle, therefore, required an armed guard, and MacArthur learned to routinely carry his pistol when he set out on work duty. One day, he and his men went to another island, Jimaras, to look for lumber for the piers and docks they were building. As he wandered down the jungle trail and kept looking up ahead for trees tall and sturdy enough to cut down, he realized he had become separated from his work party. At a turn in the trail, he also came upon an armed man with a rifle blocking his path. MacArthur quickly glanced over his shoulder and found another blocking the path behind him. There was no time to think. The first brigand raised his rifle and fired at MacArthur's head. The bullet whizzed through his sweat-stained campaign hat, but somehow missed his skull, smacking into a sapling behind him instead. The first of Douglas MacArthur's many miraculous brushes with death. By now, he had his pistol out. He quickly fired one shot at the first brigand, dropping him in the path. Then he swiveled, aimed, and drilled the second through the head before the man had time to raise his rifle. The sound of shots had drawn the attention of his sergeant foreman, who came running up to find his lieutenant standing over two dead bodies, his gun drawn, and his hat still smoking from the first brigand's shot. The sergeant bent down to make sure the two gorillas were dead. Then, rolling his quid of tobacco into the hollow of his cheek, this was how MacArthur later remembered it, he slowly drew himself up to his full 6 feet, his heels clicking together, saluted, and drawled in his rich Irish brogue, "Begging the lieutenant's pardon, but all the rest of the lieutenant's life is pure velvet." And describing the incident in a letter to his mother, he wrote of the almost pleasant sound of a bullet whistled by his head. It was the kind of remark Winston Churchill might make, who had his baptism of fire on almost the same date in the Boer War, and famously said that nothing was more exhilarating than being shot at without result. Still, if a brigand's bullet couldn't cut him down, malaria did. To recuperate, he was given leave to return to Manila, where in the spring of 1904 he took and passed his examination for promotion to first lieutenant. One part of the exam was an oral question. What would Lieutenant MacArthur do, he was sternly asked, if he had to defend a harbor like Manila's from a combined naval and amphibious assault, but lacked any troops? MacArthur thought for a moment, then said, "First, I'd round up all the sign painters in the community and put them to work making signs reading, 'Beware, this harbor is mined.' I'd float these signs out to the harbor mouth. After that, I'd get down on my knees. Then I'd go out and fight like hell. It was pure MacArthur, father and son." Douglas became a first lieutenant. Life became easier as a result. His superiors weren't as inclined to waste the son of the great Arthur MacArthur on tedious and dangerous duties out in the jungle as a first lieutenant. He settled down to a series of desk jobs as assistant to the chief engineer in Manila, although he was also sent out to survey the harbor at Mariveles, at the tip of the Bataan Peninsula, where he concluded that Aguinaldo had been right to plan to make his last stand in that rough, rugged terrain. It never crossed his mind that 3.5 decades later, forces under his command would be making their own last stand there, against a foe far deadlier than Aguinaldo. In the evenings, Douglas had time to come back to Manila, where he had been made a member of the Army and Navy Club, and where one evening he had dinner with two young Filipino lawyers who would play a major part in his later career. One was Sergio Osmeña, who had joined MacArthur in the first landing in the Philippines in 1944 and would become the country's first president after the defeat of Japan. The other was Manuel Quezon, a striking 28-year-old who had been Aguinaldo's chief aide, but who had abandoned the insurrection after his master's capture. Quezon was part of a growing generation of young Eastern intellectuals who had learned to resent the dominance of white colonial powers over their peoples and were looking for ways to break free from dependence on the West while still retaining its respect. Quezon's greatest dreams before and after the Spanish-American War was the independence of his country. If he couldn't do it by driving the Americans out, he concluded, then he would have to do it with their help. He had been impressed by the generosity of the post-war administration toward Filipinos, and by the work of reconstruction that Arthur MacArthur had begun. Like his contemporary Sun Yat-sen, Quezon believed that Western-style politics and a Western-style constitution would make his people free and happy. He was on the lookout for American allies who could make it happen, and in his encounter with Douglas MacArthur, he found one that he relied on until his death. As for Douglas, the days when he wasn't on Bataan, he was able to wander Manila's ancient winding streets. He walked past the stone and stucco houses, explored Intramuros' shops, and lively market stalls, and rode the rickshaws, a mode of transport imported from Japan, that took a foreign visitor anywhere he wanted to go in the blazing heat of midday. Later, he would remember with enthusiasm those palmy days. The delightful hospitality, the respect and affection expressed for my father, and the languorous lays that seemed to glamorize even the most routine chores of life. The fun-loving men, the moonbeam delicacy of its lovely women, fastened me with a grip that has never relaxed. Unfortunately, the grip of malaria did not relax either, and in October he was ordered home to recover. He would spend a year in San Francisco recuperating, with light duties supervising the Golden Gate Harbor defenses. The rest of his time was devoted to chatting with his mother, traveling on horseback in the high country of the Sierra Nevada as part of a commission assigned to clean up the debris left by placer mining for gold, and dreaming of the lush languor and moonbeam delicate ladies of the Philippines. They were days when it must have seemed as if he were drowning in honey, and perhaps boredom. Then, on October 5th, 1905, a telegram arrived that would transform his life. It was from the Army's acting chief of staff and was headed Special Order 222. It ordered MacArthur to be relieved of all duties and to proceed forthwith to Tokyo, Japan. There he would be the aide-de-camp to the acting American military attaché, who had arrived there 7 months earlier. That attaché was none other than his father, Major General Arthur MacArthur. It was a dream come true for Lieutenant Douglas MacArthur, serving full time in an official capacity with the father he worshipped. For Arthur MacArthur, it was a dream come true for other reasons. The job he had applied for in vain more than 20 years earlier was now his, except it was in Japan rather than China, a change that represented a rapid shift in the balance of power in Asia. Back in February, Japan had launched a surprise naval attack on Port Arthur, a Russian-held outpost in what had been Chinese Manchuria. The Russo-Japanese War was on, and from his desk in San Francisco, Arthur MacArthur watched its progress with growing fascination. The Japanese had used a new military technology, the torpedo, to cripple the Russian fleet at Port Arthur. At the end of March, their new modern navy wiped out the Russian fleet at Vladivostok, while Russian and Japanese armies battled back and forth using the new technologies of modern land war like the landmine, the field mortar, and the machine gun. Arthur MacArthur grasped that point at once and put in a request for assignment to the Far East as a military observer. His hope was to witness at least one major battle and study the field organization of the Japanese army. MacArthur's appointment that December lent seniority to a delegation of American officers already headed for Tokyo, including three of MacArthur's own protégés, Colonel Enoch Crowder, his former adjutant, Major Peyton March, who had risen from the field artillery to become another MacArthur aide, and Captain John J. Pershing, who had also served with MacArthur in the Philippines and was destined to be a rising star in the modern army. On February 14, 1905, just as their son was settling into his desk duties in Manila, Arthur and Pinky set sail from San Francisco aboard the SS Korea. Also on board were Captain Pershing and his wife, and a friendship blossomed between the Pershings and the MacArthurs that would later bear strange fruit for their son Douglas. They reached Yokohama on March 5th, and when they arrived in Tokyo, General MacArthur found to his surprise that he was the center of enormous attention. Japan's generals had studied his campaigns in the Philippines with intense interest. especially his war of rapid maneuver against the Philippine National Army. They had even adopted some of his tactics for their own campaign against the Russians in Manchuria, which reached a climax on March 8th at the Battle of Mukden. The same day, the government held an enormous banquet in MacArthur's honor. The banquet was regularly interrupted by hourly bulletins reporting the fighting at Mukden, prompting loud cheers from the Japanese attendees as the battle steadily tipped in Japan's favor. By the time the MacArthurs and Pershings returned to the Imperial Hotel, crowds filled the streets chanting "Banzai," as the full extent of the victory became clear. Japan's rank as a great power was complete. Arthur MacArthur did not see any battles firsthand, or modern weapons like machine guns used in action, but he did arrive in time to watch the Japanese mop up isolated pockets of Russian resistance. While the trip from Dairen, the main Japanese supply base in Manchuria, to Mukden, revealed the dismal detritus of war. Smashed villages, abandoned artillery and supply wagons, and thousands of unburied dead Russian soldiers. The Japanese let him talk to Russian prisoners of war, who at the time were treated far better than the prisoners they would take from his son's army. He also met the Japanese victors, including the commander of all Japanese forces in Manchuria, Field Marshal Oyama Iwao, and General Kuroki Tamitomo, commander of the Japanese First Army, with whom Arthur MacArthur remained friends for the rest of his life. At every level, MacArthur found the Japanese to be superior soldiers than their Russian rivals. If anything, he was on the verge of becoming a true Nipponophile, and the Japanese army on the verge of finding a new idol in the person of General Arthur MacArthur. When MacArthur returned to Tokyo in August, however, he discovered that the general mood regarding Americans had abruptly changed. Japan's victory on land at Mukden had been followed in May by a victory at sea in the Tsushima Strait, separating Korea and Japan, when Japan Admiral Togo sank or captured 32 of the 35 ships in the Russian Baltic Sea Fleet, which had traveled 18,000 miles to encounter complete and humiliating annihilation. Total Japanese losses were 110 sailors. But then President Theodore Roosevelt decided it was time to bring Russia's string of defeats to an end and intervene, not with ships or soldiers, but with a pen. He summoned the Russian and Japanese ambassadors from Washington to his vacation home in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, where, under the president's watchful eye, they agreed to a peace treaty with Russia surrendering Manchuria and North Korea to Japan. Roosevelt saw the treaty as a way to maintain the complex and shifting balance of power between Japan and Russia, as well as a way to exert American influence in Asia for the first time. The Japanese, however, were furious at Roosevelt's compromise because it cheated them of the full fruits of victory. It also left Japan with an enormous war debt, which the government in Tokyo had told the Japanese public would be paid off by the Russians as part of a war indemnity. Huge anti-American demonstrations broke out across the country, and hundreds of Japanese committed suicide over what they saw as a national humiliation. Gazing from his hotel room at the angry crowds and anti-American signs, Arthur MacArthur realized his welcome in Japan was over. His own physical resemblance to Roosevelt, down to the barrel chest, bristling mustache, and pince-nez, certainly didn't help matters. Time to go. But to where? There could be only one answer in his mind: the Philippines. He had already sent that wish on to the administration, which was why Taft was in Tokyo at the same time. He hoped to block MacArthur's return to the Philippines. During their time together, the two men had clashed bitterly over American policy in the islands, especially on the issue of Philippine independence. Arthur MacArthur was a keen believer in granting it at once, while Taft and the rest of the Roosevelt administration preferred to wait. So rather than allow his rival to return to the Philippines and restore his influence there, Taft proposed an alternative. Why didn't MacArthur take an officially sanctioned tour of Asia, with his able young son Douglas as his military aide? Surprised and delighted, MacArthur accepted on the spot. He forgot about returning to the Philippines, as Taft had hoped he would. This tour would not only reunite Pinky and him with their youngest son, but it would also allow his son to get his first look at the future face of modern war. Not in Europe, where no one anticipated any military conflict, but in Asia, the crucible of empire building and America's future influence. So the telegram had gone out to San Francisco, and on Sunday, October 29th, 1905, Douglas MacArthur arrived in Japan for the first time. It was more than 40 years before he would return. At the time, I was deeply impressed by and filled with admiration for the thrift, courage, and friendliness of the ordinary Japanese, Douglas remembered, while the city of Tokyo itself would have galvanized his imagination with its strange contrast between old and new. Trains and smokestacked factories surrounded the outskirts of Tokyo, while businessmen and officials dressed in suits and top hats bustled through the streets of the Ginza and Marunouchi districts, just as they did in New York's Wall Street. Yet around the corner, barefoot peddlers and rickshaws crammed ancient alleyways, along with men and women in kimonos, like scenes from a Japanese scroll painting. He also met many Japanese army officers, grim, taciturn, aloof men of iron character and unshakable purpose, as well as the victor of Tsushima, Admiral Togo. The young lieutenant was also impressed by the ferocious discipline imposed on the Japanese soldier, especially the ordinary private. As one recruit later remembered, personality ceased to exist. There was only rank. You became lowest of the low, condemned to cook, clean, drill, and run from dawn to dusk. You could be beaten for anything, being too short or too tall, even because somebody didn't like the way you drank coffee. Each man was schooled to accept unquestioningly the order of his group leader, and above all, the will of the emperor. One story in particular stuck in MacArthur's mind many years later. To combat an outbreak of beriberi, the government distributed a pill with the label, "To prevent beriberi, take one pill 3 times a day. Like soldiers everywhere, MacArthur remembered, they took the pill once, spat it out, then dumped the can into the mud. The surgeon in charge was stumped until a bright young officer suggested a new label. "The emperor desires you to take one pill 3 times a day. The problem was solved. Every pill was taken exactly as ordered. In fact, nothing but death itself could stop the soldiers from taking the medicine. But the tour of military Japan was just the curtain raiser for what Douglas MacArthur admitted later was, without doubt, the most important factor of preparation in my entire life. In some respects, even more important than West Point. An 8-month tour of Asia, from November 1905 to June 1906, that started in Singapore and ended back in Japan. What Douglas MacArthur saw was the Asia that the European colonial powers had made at the very end of the Victorian era. but he also saw the abundant opportunities for America to exert its commercial, military, and cultural muscle, once it had committed itself to a decisive turn to the Far East. In the words of Albert Beveridge, "The power that rules the Pacific is the power that rules the world." To the MacArthurs, both father and son, that power was destined to be the United States. The first stop on the tour was Singapore on November 23rd. Founded in 1819, it was the main trading post for Great Britain in Asia, even greater than Hong Kong, and a military bastion of Britain's possessions east of India. Arthur and Douglas MacArthur met the British governor and reviewed the British troops on the island city. Then they toured other military bases on the Malay Peninsula before setting sail for Jakarta and the Dutch East Indies on November 28. The future capital of Indonesia, Jakarta, or Batavia, as the Dutch named it, bore the physical traces of a long colonial history, with European-style whitewashed buildings and houses, some dating back to the 17th century. The Dutch also maintained an impressive garrison of Dutch and native troops. But as with Singapore and other stops, MacArthur saw firsthand the strengths and weakness of the colonial system, he wrote, how it brought law and order, but failed to develop the masses along the essential lines of education and political economy. As he walked the streets with his mother striding sturdily beside him, he rubbed elbows with millions of underprivileged who knew nothing about economics or democracy, or anything else, but who were interested only in getting a little more food in their stomachs, a little better coat on their backs, a little stronger roof over their heads. A system of government that promised more of all three, he realized, would mean more to ordinary Asians than any promises of constitutions or self-governance, or even civil liberties. It was a lesson that enabled him to understand the appeal of communism in Asia after 1945, as well as the need for America and the West to forge the material and cultural as well as military tools to combat it. The MacArthurs' time in the Dutch East Indies passed slowly. This was due in part because of tropical heat and irregular connections, General MacArthur noted, but also because with his usual thoroughness, he insisted on visiting no fewer than 12 military bases, covering 1,200 miles by train and carriage in a little over 3 weeks. The trio then returned briefly to Singapore for Christmas before setting out for Burma. They traveled first to Mandalay in Upper Burma, which Winston Churchill's father Randolph had added to the British Empire in 1892, before traveling by steamer to what would be the heart of their Asian tour, India. Starting on January 14th in Calcutta, the MacArthurs would spend nearly 8 weeks in India, seeing everything from Calcutta and the Himalayas to Ceylon, Bangalore, the northwest frontier, and the Khyber Pass bordering on Afghanistan, while stopping at virtually every military installation along the way. "In order to expedite my observations," General MacArthur informed Washington, "all the generals concerned practically put their commands under emergency orders." What he and Douglas witnessed was the deployment of the largest all-volunteer army in the world, nearly 250,000 strong, and made up of every race and religion in India, with a small but sturdy cluster of British regiments to round out the force. The Indian Army was the military juggernaut of Asia, and a reminder to both MacArthurs of what an alliance of Western and Eastern soldiers could accomplish, given enough resources and motivation. At the time, however, what Douglas particularly relished was the conversations between his father and the Indian Army's Commander-in-Chief, Lord Kitchener. The greatest living British soldier and the greatest living American soldier, certainly in Douglas's mind, shared memories of past and present battles, including those with their own governments. Kitchener himself was in the midst of an imbroglio with the Viceroy Lord Curzon, about which he discoursed at bitter length. No doubt it also reminded Arthur MacArthur of his own problems dealing with William Howard Taft in the Philippines. Douglas's memoirs state that both men gave him a foretaste of the age-old struggle between the civil and the military to fix the exact line of demarcation between executive control and the professional duty of the soldiers, while leaving him little doubt who should prevail and who had no business prevailing in that struggle. By the time the MacArthurs left India, they had logged no fewer than 19,000 miles of travel. But there was still more to come, including a stop in the one remaining independent power in Southeast Asia, Siam, today Thailand. They arrived in Bangkok on March 27, 1906, where their reception by King Chulalongkorn and a formal dinner in their honor led American Ambassador Hamilton King to report that no man has been accorded such a royal and generous welcome as was the general since I have been in this country. According to a recently discovered diary kept by King's wife, the MacArthurs spent virtually every day touring military barracks, schools, and prisons in the Siamese interior, traveling by private rail car to Ratchaburi, the province west of Bangkok bordering Burma, with a Siamese aide-de-camp before joining the entire party on a picnic boat to see the largest sitting Buddha in the world at Ayutthaya. On returning to Bangkok, they became virtual pet visitors of the king, especially Pinky, who, with her usual combination of charm and audacity, could be heard saying to the all-powerful monarch, "Oh, Your Majesty, you're such a darling. And, oh, I should like to see you on your throne," which he agreed to do, while she stood before him doing a series of mock bows, all to the horror of his courtiers. At one point, she even took the king's arm as they walked through the palace, an unheard-of liberty, but to Pinky as natural as anything in the world. For Douglas, the highlight of the Bangkok visit was a ceremonial banquet during which the electric lights suddenly went out, plunging the entire court in darkness. "I had noticed a fuse box near where I was seated," he later recalled, "and promptly replaced the burned-out fuse. A grateful king offered to present the young lieutenant with a medal there and then. Happily, I had the common sense to decline. The first and last time Douglas MacArthur ever refused a decoration." From Bangkok, the MacArthurs set out for Saigon, capital of French Indonesia, and cockpit of a future American land war, and then to Canton, which was their introduction to the tragic reality of China. Humiliated by a series of treaties imposed on the imperial government by Europeans, crushed and broken by the defeat of the recent Boxer Rebellion, what was once the most sophisticated civilization in the world was now a shambling, moribund empire in the process of being pulled apart by stronger, more ruthless hands, including Japan, and teetering on national disaster. The emperor's mandate of heaven that had ruled China for 3,000 years had only 5 years left of life before it collapsed. Revolution and chaos would soon sweep the entire country. Eventually, it would engulf the rest of Asia. Yet walking the streets of Shanghai with its large modern European buildings and Western-style shops and conveniences, and then gazing on the imperial capital of Peking with its elaborate fortifications and magnificent Forbidden Palace, Not even a prescient observer like Arthur MacArthur could guess that the coming Chinese Revolution would shake every nation involved in the continent, including the United States, and ultimately trigger a war that would propel his own son into the front lines. But earth-shaking news of a different kind was waiting for them when they returned to Japan. A great earthquake had hit San Francisco on April 18th, making the MacArthurs anxious for news about Douglas's sister-in-law, Mary, and her son, Arthur IV. Commander Arthur MacArthur had been at sea when the quake happened. The mother and son were safe, but when the general and his wife returned to San Francisco on August 2nd, they came back to a shattered city. He would soon set aside his report on the Asian tour and plunge headlong into coordinating the Army's effort to help rebuild. But he had reasons to be satisfied. His Asian tour had been a huge personal and professional success. He was barely back a month before he received news that he had been promoted to Lieutenant General, the Army's highest rank, with a raise in salary from $7,500 to $11,000 a year, roughly $250,000 today. He had 2.5 years to go before retirement, and he had every reason to assume that those years would be rounded out by appointment to the Army's highest post, that of Chief of Staff. Still, there were aspects to his Asian trip that had disquieted him. As he sat in his office in San Francisco working on the report for the War Department that he would never finish, he saw looming before him and before America what he termed the problem of the Pacific. He had witnessed firsthand the rise of Japan to great power status, an advance that the Roosevelt administration had welcomed as a counterweight to Russia. But MacArthur realized that Japan's rise posed a potential threat, not only to the stability of the region, but to the survival of Western colonial empires, which, it seemed, were inclined to underestimate the challenge that Japan represented. The other country threatened by Japan's rise, he believed, was the Philippines. Those islands were still very much on his mind. After his tour of India, the Dutch East Indies and Malaya, as well as Burma and the Chinese ports under European treaty, he had to concede the general good administration apparent in certain colonial territories. But he went on to say that self-supporting germinal ideas have not been introduced into any sphere of influence in the East, excepting in the Philippines, especially the idea of self-governing independence. Then he pulled out his own crystal ball and predicted that this failure to expand Western-style opportunities for the Asian masses would fatally weaken these ostentatious colonial governments in the final struggle with the Orient, including possibly Japan. This would leave the United States as the one remaining Western power of significance, with the Philippines as its vital outpost and its closest Asian ally. His one wish now was that the Philippines would continue as the living embodiment of the idea that the imperishable ideas upon which free institutions are based, life, liberty, the rule of law, and the pursuit of happiness, can succeed with non-white populations in Asia. His own dream was that America would be both inspiration and protector of that precious ideal. Both were audacious hopes. Certainly, as a forecast of the rise of Japan signaling the twilight of Europe's colonial empires, General MacArthur was breathtakingly prescient. So was his prediction that America would be the great benefactor, but also beneficiary of the new Asia that took their place. This, in fact, would be the great MacArthur family compact, embracing both father and son. Together, they would support the proposition that the Philippines would light the lamp of America's Pacific destiny, not as a seaborne empire like Great Britain's, or even a commercial power, as Albert Beveridge and others hoped, but as the carrier of the ideal of human liberty to Asia. This was why Arthur MacArthur was able to assert that the American occupation of the Philippines was the most important event recorded in the annals of mankind since the discovery of this continent, meaning America itself, and why he believed that the essential mission for America was to strengthen the defenses of the Philippines before the coming storm, in order to prevent its strategic position from becoming a liability rather than an asset to the United States. It would be left to his son to carry out the mission that the father outlined to his superiors in Washington 3 decades earlier. As for Lieutenant Douglas MacArthur, the tour had certainly been an eye-opening experience. The true historic significance and the sense of destiny that these lands of the Western Pacific and Indian Ocean now assumed became part of me, he would write. Here lived almost half the population of the world, and probably more than half of the raw products to sustain future generations. Here was Western civilization's last earth frontier. It was crystal clear to me that the future, and indeed the very existence of America, were irrevocably entwined with Asia and its island outposts, most particularly the Philippines. His father would be the first to wholeheartedly agree, and the first to reproach him if he ever let the mission down. When he returned to the United States that August, Douglas MacArthur was 26 years old and a rising star. He was West Point's most stellar graduate and the son of the Army's most prominent general. He had seen things and met people that most officers in the U.S. Army barely dreamed of. A vigorous life and a promising career stretched out before him. His assignment that autumn to the elite engineering school at the Washington Barracks, now Fort McNair, clearly confirmed that. So did appointment in December as aide-de-camp to President Theodore Roosevelt himself. Still, the mundane duties of an engineering classroom and standing at attention at social functions and shuffling papers, even if they were for the President of the United States, must have been a letdown after what he had seen and done in Asia. For the first and only time in his life, Douglas MacArthur became a slouch, and his efficiency report showed it. I am sorry to report that during this time Lieutenant MacArthur seemed to take but little interest in his course at the school, read one evaluation written by the engineering school's commandant. Throughout the time Lieutenant MacArthur was under my observation, he displayed on the whole but little professional zeal, and his work was far inferior to that which his West Point record showed him capable of. Teddy Roosevelt certainly enjoyed his conversations with the young lieutenant and was greatly interested in my views on the Far East and talked with me long and often, MacArthur later recalled. But it was the efficiency reports that mattered. And they got worse when he was dispatched on special duty to Milwaukee in August 1907 to work on plans to refurbish several harbors on Lake Michigan. On the one hand, returning to Milwaukee also meant being reunited with his family. His father was serving out his last 2 years there on detached duty and had rented a large house at 575 Marshall Street. On the other, his dissatisfaction with what seemed to him tedious duties that wasted his talents led to a direct conflict with his commanding officer, Major William V. Judson, and to reports like this. Lieutenant MacArthur exhibited less interest in and put in less time upon the drafting room, the plans and specifications for work, and the works themselves than seemed consistent with my instructions. He was absent from the office during office hours more than I thought proper. When Judson tried to give him a different assignment he thought the lieutenant might profit from, MacArthur remonstrated and argued verbally at length against assignment to this duty, which would take him away from Milwaukee for a considerable portion of the time, which meant away from his mother. Judson's efficiency report concluded, Lieutenant MacArthur, while on duty under my immediate orders, did not conduct himself in a way to meet commendation. His duties were not performed in a satisfactory manner. When MacArthur learned of the damning document, the result was an unholy row. He was already furious that he had been turned down for a teaching appointment at West Point. He also knew the Judson report would be a permanent part of his record. He fired off an angry letter to the Brigadier Chief of Engineers, protesting, "The ineradicable blemish Major Judson has seen fit to place on my military record," and trying to justify his frequent absences on the grounds that there didn't seem to be a lot to do and he wouldn't be missed. What he got back was a stern rebuke from the Brigadier, who reminded him that an officer's job was to obey orders, and that MacArthur's special pleading was itself justification of Major Judson's statement, in view of Mr. MacArthur's evident inclination to avoid work. This led to a stormy family scene, with Pinky urging her son to think about resigning. She even sent a letter to his father's railroad baron friend, E.H. Harriman, wondering if he might have some suitable position for her 29-year-old son. When Douglas learned of her scheme, he was even more furious. He told Harriman's talent scout he had absolutely no plans to get out of the Army. If he did, it certainly wouldn't be in the railroad. But the fact was, he was bored. He couldn't help it if he came across like a spoiled brat. He was waiting for his next big career break. And it wasn't coming. So, like lots of bored young men, he fell in love. Her name was Fanny Bell Stewart. She was from Milwaukee, and for the first time, Douglas MacArthur thought seriously about getting married. What Miss Stewart thought, we do not know. None of her letters survive. But what does survive is a series of romantic poems that Douglas composed for her. The earliest, a 26-page epic in rhyming couplets that tells us much more about Douglas's view on war, his profession, and his relationship with his father than it does about young love. Although it starts conventionally enough with references to songs of the birds and the hum of the bees, it soon shifts to a tragic narrative of a young soldier leaving his wife, Fan, to go to war. He goes for home and for children, for freedom, for bread. For the house of our God, for the graves of our dead. And she responds dutifully, like a true Spartan wife. I grudge you not, Douglas, die rather than yield. And like the old heroes, come home on your shield. And so he goes, but soon returns gravely wounded after a battle that clearly takes place in the Civil War. And so after a long convalescence at home, he returns to the fight to find the hero's ultimate reward as Douglas merges into his father's image on Missionary Ridge. Our cavalry bore themselves splendidly. Far in front of his line galloped Colonel MacArthur, erect in his stirrups, his sword flashing high, and the look of a patriot kindling his eye. Remember Wisconsin, remember your wives, and on to your duty, boys, on with your lives. He turned and he paused as he uttered the call, then reeled in his seat and fell, pierced by a ball. The stanza ends with the hero Douglas having but one final wish, to look on his wife. But his true wish was clearly for a chance to lead troops gallantly in battle like his father had, and to be the great hero. That opportunity wasn't forthcoming, however, and so after a few more months of passionate love letters and poems, when Fanny Bell moved to New York City, fair Gotham girl, with life a whirl of dance and fancy free, 'tis thee I love, all things above. Why canst thou not love me? The romance died of its own accord. Love is at best a tragic joke. Begun in flames, it ends in smoke. But even as he was writing his last letter to her, wishing her good luck and good luck, a friend of his father's had come to his rescue. Major General J. Franklin Bell, the chief of staff, arranged for the wayward lieutenant to get a posting to Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, to train a company of new volunteers. Kansas looked bleak after Milwaukee, let alone Peking and Tokyo. The company, K Company, was the last on the list of 26 companies getting training at the post. But this was what Lieutenant Douglas MacArthur had been waiting for. Leading men, if not exactly into battle, at least into the rigors of a soldier's life. Marching 25 miles a day, building pontoon bridges at record speed, learning marksmanship, horsemanship, and demolition. He fell in love with command at once. "I couldn't have been happier," he wrote, "if they made me a general." He wrote a field manual on demolition, took over as the post quartermaster, commissary officer, engineer officer, and disbursing officer, and managed the baseball team. He turned his efficiency reports around. "A most excellent and efficient officer," the next one read. One day on the parade ground, he heard a veteran sergeant major tell his men, "Boys, there goes a soldier." It was a tribute that MacArthur remembered almost 60 years later. "I prize more than any other." Others remembered him, too. One was a Lieutenant Robert Eichelberger, who recalled seeing him in front of a drugstore one evening, standing a bit aloof from the rest of us and looking off in the distance, with an expression that Eichelberger could only describe as Napoleonic. Another lieutenant at Leavenworth who regarded him with awe was Walter Kruger, 30 years later the commander of MacArthur's 6th Army. One lieutenant who didn't was a hard-faced, gravelly graduate from Virginia Military Institute named George Catlett Marshall. Their lack of love for each other would reach new heights during the Second World War. While both Kruger and Eichelberger would command armies for MacArthur in New Guinea and the Philippines. These were good days for MacArthur for another reason. In February 1911, his promotion came through to captain. He was finally going places in his career after 8 years of struggle. He had the respect of the men serving under him and the officers serving with him. Most who served with MacArthur at Leavenworth remembered him as a gregarious companion who drank little but loved long sessions at the poker table wreathed in cigar smoke. They remembered stag parties with MacArthur, Eichelberger, and the other officers draped around the piano while someone banged on the jangling keys and all sang one of the popular songs of the day, "Old Soldiers Never Die." Chapter 5. Countdown to War. Every head swiveled as Arthur MacArthur entered the room. It was September the 5th, 1912, a warm Thursday. Across the Atlantic in Vienna, Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria was meeting with his father, Emperor Franz Joseph, to decide what to do about troublesome Serbian nationalists in the Austrian province of Bosnia. Across the Pacific, in Tokyo, courtiers and officials were preparing the ceremonial funeral for Emperor Mutsuhito, who had died in July. In a few days, the proclamation would come of his successor, Emperor Taisho, and the next crown prince, Taisho's 11-year-old son, Hirohito. But here in Milwaukee, the 64 remaining veterans of the 24th Wisconsin were holding their 50th reunion. All day, the Milwaukee Chamber of Commerce had held celebrations, a parade, and now there was a banquet at Walcott Hall in their honor, and to honor their famous commander who was to be the guest speaker. The Arthur MacArthur who climbed the rostrum with difficulty was a changed man from the tough, confident Teddy Roosevelt lookalike who had triumphantly completed his tour of Asia, let alone the curly-haired 18-year-old who had charged up Missionary Ridge almost 60 years before. That summer, his kidneys had begun to give out and high blood pressure to set in. His stomach gave him constant problems with hyperacidity, a problem that would also plague his son in later years. And walking had become a growing challenge. But even worse, since he had returned from Asia, his professional life had been one of constant disappointment. He had hoped to be appointed chief of staff, but in January 1907, the post went instead to J. Franklin Bell, the youngest major general in the Army. MacArthur, the most senior lieutenant general in the Army, bitterly protested being passed over for its youngest major general. President Roosevelt explained that they needed a man who would serve out the full 4-year term as chief of staff, not one slated to retire in 2 years. MacArthur was furious. He refused to accept the other commands they offered, including the Department of the East, headquartered in New York City, as unbefitting an officer of his rank. In the end, he angrily proposed that they send him home to Milwaukee on detached duty until retirement finally came in June 1909. "I'm glad to be back home," he told a newspaper reporter. He had continued to read voraciously, had led long discussions on military history, economics, and geopolitics with Douglas, and had started work on his memoirs as he relived the campaigns that had made him a state and national hero, the greatest soldier Wisconsin had ever produced. But the bitterness of personal defeat was written on his face, and it began to rack his body. That August, his doctors had even put him to bed and advised him not to go to the 50th celebration on one of the hottest days of the year. But Arthur MacArthur was determined to meet his old comrades and speak to them one last time. It was approaching 10 o'clock before MacArthur was finally introduced by an old friend who had been with him in the famous charge up Missionary Ridge, former Captain Ed Parsons. His fellow soldiers were now white-haired and bent with age, but they stood and cheered for 6 to 7 minutes before he could begin to speak. "Comrades," he began, "little did we imagine 50 years ago that we would ever gather in this way. Little did we think that on that march to Atlanta so many of us would be spared to see Wisconsin again." He spoke of the joys and misery of those days, one participant recalled, and the valor they had all shown in the midst of the country's bloodiest conflict. "Your indomitable regiment." Then Arthur MacArthur froze. He staggered slightly and grew pale. "Comrades," he gasped, "I cannot go on. I am too weak. I must sit down." There was a hushed gasp as he suddenly clutched at his heart, slumped in his chair, and closed his eyes. Then his head fell forward and every man in the room rushed to the podium. Already his face had assumed the pallor of death, one eyewitness said, and he lay back in his chair, breathing easily. They moved him to a couch where two veterans who were also doctors tended to their old commanding officer. Suddenly, one of them grasped the general's wrist, laid his head on the man's breast, and then straightened up. "Comrades," he said in a soft voice, "our commander has gone to his last rest." It had been a sudden aneurysm at the base of the brain. Death was almost instantaneous. Heartbroken and with heads bowed, the surviving veterans of the 24th began reciting the Lord's Prayer, led by one old soldier who could barely speak through his sobs. Another took up the flag they had brought with them from the state capitol, the same torn and begrimed flag that MacArthur had carried up Missionary Ridge, and draped it over his body. Others gathered around Ed Parsons, who was devastated by the death of his old friend. "We've been so long together," he kept saying in between bursts of tears. Then suddenly he grasped at his head and slumped to the floor. Dr. Cronin sprang to the side of his second patient in as many minutes. Ed Parsons had suffered a massive stroke. He later recovered. Some carried him out of the room while others gathered around the body of their fallen commander and continued to pray. So it was not Parsons, but another old friend, Charlie King, who had to break the news to Pinky. Dr. Cronin had called her at the Marshall Street house, but could not bring himself to tell her that her husband was dead. He told her only that he had taken seriously ill. So King and two others who had attended the reunion walked to Marshall Street, where they found Pinky waiting on the steps. "Is the general dead?" It was the first thing she said. They sadly answered, "Yes." She went back into the house and was barely able to speak for the next 4 days. But she did have the strength to send the news to Douglas by telegram out at Leavenworth. "My whole world changed that night," Douglas remembered. "Never have I been able to heal the wound in my heart." The man he revered as a hero and role model was gone. Indeed, for 2 weeks after his father's death, Douglas suffered a prolonged bout of insomnia serious enough to alarm the doctors at Leavenworth. But even worse, the man whom his mother had relied on for emotional and financial support was gone, leaving her without the most important person in her life. For some sons, the loss of a larger-than-life, overbearing father might be liberating. Instead, it thrust Douglas deeper into emotional dependence on his mother, whose health began to deteriorate almost the same day her husband died. After the funeral, flags across Milwaukee flew at half-mast for 4 days, while tributes from soldiers, politicians, and foreign dignitaries poured in with every post. Douglas had to make arrangements for his mother's future. Despite the fact that her older son's wife and young family would have been happy to take her in, Pinky chose to rely on Douglas. Taking her to Leavenworth was out of the question. Instead, he began seeking a post in the nation's capital. Since Washington, on account of its proximity to Johns Hopkins Hospital, would offer more of advantage to Mrs. MacArthur than any other possible station, he told his commanding officer. Of course, a posting to Washington wouldn't hurt his own career chances either. It was another old friend of his father, General Leonard Wood, who came through this time. He caught a glimpse of Douglas's application for a transfer and passed it along to the new Secretary of War, Henry L. Stimson, who, in view of the distinguished service of General Arthur MacArthur, agreed to the transfer in the office of General Wood on the Engineering Board. He left Leavenworth in December 1912. He was embarking on what would be the next dramatic phase of his life, but without his father as teacher and mentor. He did have his mother's advice and unshakable support, as well as help from his father's protégés like Bell and Wood. In normal times, that would have been more than enough for an ambitious and gifted young officer. But these were not normal times. Their world, and his, was about to explode in the greatest conflagration in history. The Douglas MacArthur, who appeared in Washington in 1913, was a slim and handsome bachelor of 32 years of age, the sort of elegant young man one would expect to meet in an ad for Arrow shirts of the day. His was certainly an existence anyone could have envied, in or out of the Army. He lived in a fashionable apartment building in Northwest Washington, the Hadley, with his ever-present mother. A black chauffeur drove him daily from 16th Street to his equally enviable office job. First as aide to the popular and powerful General Wood, then starting in April 1913, as superintendent of the State War and Navy Building, which still stands on the corner of 17th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue, and is known as the Old Executive Office Building. Besides his mother, his brother Arthur and his family had moved to Washington as well. In addition, Douglas was surrounded by senior officers who were his father's friends, including Wood, an Army hero like his father who had helped capture Geronimo, and who as commander-in-chief in Cuba supervised Captain Walter Reed's work to find a vaccine for yellow fever, and who, it seems, singled out Captain MacArthur as his favorite aide. Even more important, the relationship with Wood brought him permanently onto the general staff, the brains of the army, that September. He was the junior member of a staff of 38 engaged in key strategic and operational planning. He was able to learn how important decisions were made in the army without yet assuming that responsibility himself. Douglas felt so comfortably ensconced that he turned down an offer from the new Democratic president, Woodrow Wilson, to become a presidential aide. The work was long and confining at the general staff, he wrote many years later, and left me little time for relaxation, but it was rewarding. It was also preparing his way for a brilliant staff career. But there were still two things missing. One was the experience he had had at Leavenworth for too short a time, that of true leadership and command, even if it was only one company at a time. The other was something his father had known and lived for, but he still did not. The experience of battle. Then, out of nowhere the following spring, he got it, in Mexico. On April 9, 1914, a detachment of sailors from the gunboat USS Dolphin went ashore at the Mexican port of Tampico to pick up a delivery of oil for their engines. It was no ordinary visit. Mexico was in the throes of a civil war pitting followers of a monocled Mexican general named Huerta against the followers of Mexico's previous president, Madero, who were besieging Huerta's troops in Tampico. The soldiers on guard in Tampico were justifiably jumpy. When the American sailors arrived, wearing unfamiliar uniforms and unable to speak a word of Spanish, they were immediately arrested and taken down to division headquarters. The next morning, the Mexican soldiers turned them loose with an apology from General Huerta himself. But the commander of American naval forces in the region, Admiral Henry Mayo, was outraged. He demanded nothing less than a 21-gun salute to the American flag to compensate for the arrests, and he let President Wilson know what he was doing. Wilson, as it happened, detested General Huerta. Huerta was a shameless freebooter who had assassinated his way into the Mexican presidency and shattered the country's fragile democracy. When Huerta, who detested Wilson with equal venom, refused Mayo's terms, Wilson decided it was time to act. On April 20th, he held a meeting with his top advisors and ordered Arthur MacArthur's former protege, Frederick Funston, now Major General Funston, down to Galveston, Texas. His orders were nothing less than to prepare an invasion of Mexico. The next day, news reached Wilson that Huerta was receiving a massive shipment of arms from Imperial Germany at the port of Veracruz, a blatant violation of the arms embargo against Mexico that Wilson had imposed 2 years earlier. That was the last straw. Without waiting for Congress, Wilson ordered an immediate dispatch of Navy ships and Marines to take Veracruz. After a fierce battle that cost 500 casualties on both sides, the Marines took the city as ordered. On April 30th, Funston and his brigade of 7,000 soldiers arrived to occupy and hold Veracruz against Huerta's men. The next day, a tall, spare figure in a battered campaign hat with two gold bars on his collar and a corncob pipe clenched between his teeth could be seen walking through the debris-strewn streets of Veracruz, dodging the stray dogs and vultures feasting on the dead animals and offal. He was Captain Douglas MacArthur, in Mexico on personal orders from General Wood himself. Just a week earlier, he had been flat on his back recovering from acute tonsillitis when a message arrived at the Hadley from General Wood to get down to the office at once. With his mother's help, he had gotten dressed and headed to the War Department building, where he found Wood surrounded by stacks of paper and fresh from a meeting with Secretary of War Lendley Garrison. Wood told him the president had ordered him to prepare and lead an expeditionary force into Mexico. He had intended to put MacArthur on his staff, but had decided instead to send his young aide out to Veracruz, first under Wood's personal orders, to make an assessment of the situation. "How soon can you leave?" Wood wanted to know. "I can be off in an hour," MacArthur replied. Less than 12 hours later, he was on board the battleship Nebraska sailing from New York, with a letter from Wood in his pocket ordering him to obtain, through reconnaissance and other means consistent with the existing situation, all possible information which would be of value in connection with possible operations. He was, in effect, Wood's personal secret agent, operating independently of General Funston or any other American authority in Veracruz. Just the kind of daring assignment Captain MacArthur had dreamed of. It was the chance at last not just to use his own judgment free of interference from his superiors, an opportunity that not many junior staff officers receive, but also to use it to affect the outcome of a future military campaign. Perhaps even shape the difference between victory and defeat. The truth was, the American situation in Veracruz was desperate. Funston's troops were hemmed in on all sides by a Mexican force that outnumbered them almost 3-2. Shades of the senior MacArthur's predicament during the siege of Manila. If the Mexicans got any wind of Wilson's plans for a full-scale invasion of Mexico, they could make things very hot for Funston and his men, and for Captain MacArthur. What Funston needed, he explained to Wood's young emissary, were two things. The first was transport, but there was none to be had in Veracruz. In the event of war, his orders would be to move forward and seize the town of Jalapa as a forward base for Wood's impending invasion. But without horses or mules or wagons, his brigade was stuck fast. There were, however, plenty of railway wagons in Veracruz. Mac's friend, Captain Constant Cordier, of the 4th Infantry Regiment, told MacArthur, but they had no railroad engines to move them. The other requirement was intelligence on what the Mexicans were up to. But Funston was leery of sending out anyone to do reconnoitering. One American had already been killed in a firefight near the town of Tejar, south of the city, and Funston had no desire to trigger any more shooting incidents. "Trouble is," Funston explained to his diary on May 3rd, "we, not being permitted to scout beyond outposts, cannot discover a concentration of Mexican troops close thereto. But one man might be able to, the man under secret orders, namely Captain Douglas MacArthur." And here Cordier had an idea. He had met a Mexican rail engineer, he told MacArthur, who had informed him that there were locomotives down Alvarado way, 40 miles southeast of Veracruz. The man was a bit of a drunkard, Cordier warned MacArthur, and since Cordier was under Funston's orders, he couldn't go with him. But if MacArthur could somehow convince the man to show him where the locomotives were and do some freelance reconnaissance at the same time, he just might be able to pull the 5th Brigade out of its predicament. MacArthur eagerly agreed. He found the engineer at a sleazy Veracruz bar, got him sobered up, and told him in the Spanish he had learned in the Philippines that he would pay $150 in gold if he could take him to Alvarado and show him the locomotives. The engineer readily agreed and made arrangements for the American captain to meet him at a railroad siding, where he would have a hand car waiting. He would also have 2 other Mexicans waiting farther down the line with another hand car to take them all the way to Alvarado. MacArthur agreed, but was adamant that only when he and the engineer returned to Veracruz would the Mexicans get their $150, and not before. The engineer eagerly ducked his head in agreement. The deal was done. MacArthur departed and went back to his rooms. He decided to take nothing except his .45 pistol, his dog tags, and a small Bible. He wasn't even traveling in uniform, though that meant that if he was caught, he could be shot as a spy. Then, as dusk settled and thunder rumbled in the distance, it was the beginning of the rainy season, Douglas MacArthur set off alone for the edge of the American lines near the Veracruz wireless station. There he disappeared into the darkness, not knowing whether he would ever come back alive. He followed the railway line in the gloom until he found his engineer companion waiting by the handcar. The young American captain pointed his pistol and had the Mexican raise his hands while he frisked him, and the man complained volubly. MacArthur took away the man's revolver and a small dirk, and then had the Mexican search him, so that he might better realize that there being nothing of value on me, my death would afford him no monetary return, as MacArthur wrote later in his report to General Wood. They set off on the handcar and got as far as Boca del Rio, where MacArthur discovered that the railroad bridge across the Jamapa River was down. They abandoned the car, crossed the river with a small boat they found on the bank, then wandered along until they discovered two ponies tied up next to a shack. No one inside noticed as they surreptitiously slipped the tethers, mounted up, and after several detours found themselves back on the line to Alvarado, which soon led them to their two companions with the second-hand car. After a quick search of those two stalwarts, MacArthur and the engineer mounted up, and they were off. "Mile after mile we covered with no sign of the engines," MacArthur wrote. Once he had to threaten the men at gunpoint to get them to cross one of the rail bridges. No one knew when they might be fired upon by sentries or even if the bridge itself might collapse. But after that, he reported laconically, they took orders in stride, and after getting into the spirit of the thing, their conduct was most admirable. MacArthur's having the only two guns in the party probably helped as well. It was after 1 o'clock in the morning when they finally reached Alvarado, 35 miles from Funston's outposts. There, the engineer led MacArthur to the siding where the locomotives were parked, 5 of them. 2, he saw, were only switch engines, useless for moving cars over a distance. But the other 3 were just what we needed, MacArthur decided. Fine big road pullers in excellent condition, except for some spare parts that could be easily replaced. He glanced at his watch. Time to go back. He and his companion had crept along as far as Salinas undetected, when suddenly 5 armed men loomed out of the darkness. They weren't wearing uniforms. MacArthur decided they were probably bandits, of which there were hundreds infesting the countryside. MacArthur and the engineer made a run for it, as the armed men opened fire and began chasing them. The pair managed to outdistance all except 2, when, in order to save our lives, the young American turned and fired back, dropping 1 and then the other. MacArthur was worried that the sound of gunfire might have scared his other 2 companions away, but they and the handcar were waiting, and soon they were whizzing away at top speed in a driving mist. The trip home soon got eventful. At Pietra, they ran into a party of 15 mounted gunmen, who blazed away at the handcars it sped by. MacArthur blazed back, hitting 4 of them, while one of his Mexicans took a bullet in the shoulder. Still, they sped on, pumping and pumping away as the miles clicked by. Then, outside Laguna, 3 more mounted men sprang up out of the pre-dawn darkness, yelling and shooting and chasing the car on horseback. One of them, unusually well mounted, managed to pass the car and straddle the track, then raised his gun and fired directly at the American. MacArthur felt the first bullet tear at his shirt, but it passed through without touching him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.